Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Hi, it's Jamie from Light FM. If you're in your mid to late 20s, even your 30s like me, with a busy career and life but still haven't found your person to settle down with, by freezing your eggs now rather than later, you can embrace the possibility of parenthood and secure your family's future on your timetable. RMA has helped thousands of women, providing access to knowledgeable fertility specialists who answer questions and can support your plan for the future. RMA is opening a Jersey City location January 2023. Plan for Sunday, today, with RMA at rmanetwork.com.
If you've been dreaming of being a parent, having watched the calendar for longer than 6 to 12 months, and your 30s is in the rearview mirror, please don't give up hope. There's an incredible team to support you. Reproductive Medicine Associates, here to help at rmanetwork.com. An extraordinarily talented team of doctors. They make it their mission to build families with success rates that far exceed the national average. And they're right here in our neighborhood. They're even opening in Jersey City in January. So when waiting for nature to take its course isn't working, it's time to go to rmanetwork.com to request an appointment. If you and your partner have been trying to have a baby, watching the calendar for longer than 6 to 12 months, but haven't had any success, finding out why can be the hardest, scariest part. Reproductive Medicine Associates is here to help you at rmanetwork.com. They've dealt with thousands of couples in this situation and help cut away from that anxiety and get you answers. There's a huge relief that comes with taking steps to find out why you aren't getting pregnant. And once you know if you have any potential issues, RMA is there to help you address them and start your family. Go to rmanetwork.com today and schedule an appointment.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
And damn, I'm glad y'all set it off. Used to be hard, now you just went soft. First you was down with the AK, and now I see you on a video with Mitchell Lake.
Welcome to Gen Exhausted. I'm Chris.
I'm Rich.
I'm Jess.
Ice Cube, he's a trailblazer. 30. Ice Cube did it first, everybody. Yeah, anyways.
I didn't even know who that was.
Oh, okay. Wow.
I mean, I know who Ice Cube is.
You
I didn't know who
who does family movies?
Right. Oh, if I let that song play, we'd hear an awful lot of anti-Semitism. Just saying. Yeah. So, Kanye's... The meltdown continues. Like, I posed this question earlier. Like, we've talked about it in weeks past. We're watching... he's got to be in the middle of a mental episode, right? Like, this is the mix of, like, mental illness, he's rich, a bunch of people around him who don't say no. Like, I feel like we're watching somebody have a manic breakdown.
Yeah, and all that.
I really don't know much about what's been going on with Kanye, truly. I've seen clips, but not, like, absolutely nothing.
Like, he said he was going to go, what, DEFCON 3 on Jewish people, I believe is the actual quote from his tweet a couple weeks ago. And he is not disappointed. I mean, he has lost all of his sponsorships. He lost it. His agent dropped him. Adidas finally dropped him this week. Gap told him to fuck off when he did that White Lives Matter stuff. I mean, this is someone in the middle of a manic breakdown. He is just torching every. He has gone scorched earth on himself.
I didn't see it. What was it he said about Jewish people? What's his deal with that?
Which thing?
The most recent.
That's a very good question. I have no idea.
Let's see.
I mean, because here's the thing. Like, unless you're going to stare and go through the timestamps on every fucking article you're looking at, this is porn to a 12-year-old that they just found, and they've never seen porn before. This is like before right. The internet. If you're our age, like Chris and I's age, you get that reference. You know what we're talking about. When we were 12, this is finding your dad's stash, and the parents ain't home. So you can look at your dick and be like, scream all you want. No one's coming for help. So, I mean, like, but besides that, yes, you're absolutely right. He is in the middle of a mental break. I don't know how anyone can deny that. Anyone who's been around someone who's had mental issues, I don't know what he's been diagnosed with. But there are a lot of common signs, things you see, certain behaviors, tics. I don't know how else to idiosyncrasies. That's not the right word, but I mean, he's showing all the signs, and he's definitely sending up red flags in my head. I mean, kind of the same like when we were talking about the George Floyd video. Like when I watched the 45-minute uncut body cam footage video. I was like, anyone looking at that man with any training or experience with people who are on massive amounts of drugs or mentally ill know he's in the middle of a psychotic break. They can see it physically in his eyes, the way he's sweating, the way his pupils look. I mean, like, there's physical tells. And I mean, like, you can see it in Kanye, like, and hear it in his voice, like, during these interviews. The interview he gave with Piers Morgan where he was, like, you know, calling him boy and shit.
Oh, yeah.
All this stuff. And, like it's like, dude, you're arguing.
He's not with us.
He was arguing with Piers Morgan, but he wasn't arguing with Piers Morgan. You know what I'm saying? Like, he was arguing with what Piers Morgan represents. And, like, in his mind, it's all the same thing. And I guarantee you he's so deep into whatever fucking kind of manic episode or whatever the fuck they call it these days. I don't care. But that, like, time is almost static. So if he's pissed at someone right now, he's always been pissed at somebody. And if he's cool with someone right now, he's always been cool with somebody. And when you're dealing with someone who's in that deep of the fucking, like, psychosis, good luck. And who's going to stop him and his fucking crew, dude?
He's rich and he's famous, so nobody tells him no. And he's mentally ill. This is just a terrible mix.
That's what killed Prince. That's what killed, in a lot of...
Probably what killed Elvis.
For sure, Elvis, Jim Morrison. I mean, to lesser extents, like people like Tom Petty. Just people who are like, you know, it's not my business. He needs pain medication. He can't get it from his doctor for whatever reason. He's getting it off the street. Yeah, well, it killed him because, you know what I'm saying? And yeah. I mean, like, if we're not going to treat addiction as a criminal issue, then it has to be some sort of health issue. You really want to treat it physically, or do you want to treat it like a mental health issue? I'd rather treat it like a mental health issue. So, yeah, there's lots of examples.
Yeah, right. You can't tell the conductor of the gravy train no, because then it stops.
And the fact that I still don't really know what he's getting at, besides he's on that, like, kind of black Israelite thing, and that, like, you know, I guess in a way he's like, the people in power are Jewish.
He did the whole Jews run Hollywood thing.
Okay, but do you understand the difference if I say Jews run Hollywood and Jews control the world, or if I say the people who run Hollywood are mostly Jews and the people who sit at the top of, you know, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
There is a difference. Now, the average person, especially in this country, is too stupid to understand nuance and context. We've obliterated it in the last decade. Job well done, America. Because we've got that. We put a man on the moon and we obliterate context and nuance in this country.
What's wrong with being stereotyped as successful?
But still, I mean, like, that's what I'm saying. Like, did he really say that? I don't know. All I hear is he said anti-Semitic shit. It's like, okay, remember when Alex Jones got banned and deplatformed and they did Farrakhan, like, the same fucking week, if not, like, the next day or whatever, and people were flipping out? And I was like, have y'all never heard Louis Farrakhan fucking talk? And I just, like, posted one video and it got taken down in a matter of hours. I'm sure someone reported it because it wasn't, like, flagged automatically for Facebook, but it was taken down because it was inflammatory and hate speech. And to this day, I don't know if it was taken down because they said I was posting hate speech or what he was saying was hate speech. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like I don't know because they never said, but I mean, he flat out is like, I'm not going to get into it. Look up Louis Farrakhan if you've never looked him up and his thoughts on the Jewish people.
Yeah.
Believe me, most people's knowledge of Louis Farrakhan ends at Bring the Noise from Tony Hawk 2. If you're under 40, you just remember him because, yeah, he was name checked in that song. There's a lot more to it than that. And then if you're really feeling froggy, look into the Nation of Islam and why Malcolm X left the Nation of Islam and who Louis Farrakhan was underneath Malcolm X. And it gets really interesting. But that's a podcast for another day. So anyways. But yeah, so I don't know what he said. And here's the thing. That's where I'm just like, is it? I don't care. Like, I can't even, unless I see an interview with him, secondhand information is I disregard. And the worst accusations I've heard supposedly of him saying anything is from that interview that they won't air from LeBron James' show.
Well, I mean, as far as I've heard, he's not throwing around the slurs.
No, he's not calling anyone ethnic or racial slurs. He's not. I mean, like, he's not even using like questionable language, which I guess is not questionable. It's like I guess Shylock is an actual term in certain part in Yiddish. And it's like, you know, people who are younger are like, oh, that's racist. It's not. It's like saying the Negro Leagues. That's what the fuck they're called. Well,
Shylock's from Shakespeare. He was the evil Jew in the one with the pound of flesh.
Okay, so that's, I get it. That's why they get angry about that. But you get my point. Like, when we say the Negro Leagues, why don't we call it the African American Leagues? Because it wasn't
called the Negro League. Yeah.
Yes. We're not going to change history because you're uncomfortable with the fucking facts, okay?
Yeah.
We already fucking go along with, yes, you have a very womanly cock. You know what I'm saying? So stop fucking with shit you don't care about. Leave baseball alone. Anyways.
Yeah, they love.
Rant over.
Well, Kanji, he hasn't used any outrageous language. His ideas have kind of been.
Okay, but if saying that you have a religious belief that you are that you and people who believe like you are an elevated people. Because of your deity that you worship, if that's hate speech, then anyone who's religious is a bigot. Because almost every religion teaches that, doesn't it? That's the beauty of it. Religion is, one of the things about religion is it's like exclusivity in certain religions make it like appealing. You know what I'm saying? Like Christianity went the other way. We're like, everybody's welcome. You just got to say the magic words and bend the knee.
Right.
You know, and like, cool. All right. This is easy. You know, but other religions, no. You see what I'm saying? Like, so.
And I know.
Whoa. You all right there?
That was my dog tripping over a phone charger that pulled an extension cord down off a table. So she panicked.
And I know this kind of goes along kind of what with Kanye was saying earlier in the week. But it did make me. How do I word this? If you're trying not, if your feathers get ruffled that Jews run the entertainment industry and you're trying to say that isn't true, wiping him out of the entertainment industry isn't helping your cause. I mean, someone like Ari Emanuel calling for like everyone who works with him to boycott him isn't helping the case for Jews don't run Hollywood. I know I'm saying it and the mic is on, but you know, we ask questions on this show.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I keep, first of all, I don't have a dog in this fight. I'm not Jewish. I don't have any even very loose connections to anyone who is. I know nothing about the inner workings or beliefs of Jewish culture from any point of view. Except for a complete outsider who's like, I'll know you're Jewish when I see you wearing a, it's called a
yarmulke.
This guy's about to call it a beanie. I swear to God. And I thought I was being respectful. I thought I was actually calling it the right thing. I don't even know. It's just, look, man, where I come from, the part of Metro Detroit I'm from, not a whole lot of Jews. Just be honest. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So, didn't grow up, don't know. But, I can, like, listening to people who I feel are the last people on earth in show business who can tell the truth, which is comedians, especially when you get like Patrice O'Neill and Bill Burr on the right show, the Opie and Anthony show, shit like that back in the day. And they would talk about it and they would say like, duh, of course the Jews run Hollywood. They built Hollywood. That's like getting mad because the Irish went into the police force and a generation later, most cops are Irish. Well, what the fuck did you think would happen?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, how did you get your job? A friend or a family member probably recommended you.
Yeah. So most people get their jobs.
So if we're in America, we're a giant game of tag, right? Tag, you're it. The new ethnicity, the new religion, the new fucking gender, whatever the fuck. You're the new fucking thing. So you get all the protection, but you also get all the bullshit. And you know what? If the stereotype about Jews are they're so good at Hollywood, they created Hollywood. They're so good at business. They created one of the most powerful fucking entertainment entities in the history of mankind. I don't know. Here's the thing. Why? I'm not Jewish. If I am, I'm not insulted by that, even though I had nothing to do with it.
What's wrong with the stereotype being we're successful at things? We run Hollywood. We're lawyers. We're accountants. You don't hear black guys running around being mad like part of the stereotype is they got big dicks. Like, that's one stereotype you do not hear black people, guys complaining about.
I've heard a few, and I'm like, just spotted the guy with a small dick.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, ooh, you're average or below, aren't you? Sorry, bro.
What's wrong with being stereotyped as successful? I don't understand that.
I don't know. And I mean, like, once again, I want to see...
Asians aren't mad at that.
I want to see uncut... No, people are mad at Asians for not being mad at that.
Asians aren't mad that we think they kick ass at everything.
No, but you know, but see, that's the thing. Everyone else is mad at Asians for not being mad about that. Tulsi Gabbard brought this up on fucking Joe Rogan. She's like, it's like when she had some sort of like prior fucking engagement, so she couldn't go to the Women's March, you know, the Pussy Hat Women's March. And... like, she tweeted out something, like, somebody was like, where are you at, Tulsi? And she's like, you know, I had a previous blah, 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 this and this. And she's like, and all these supporters just started dragging me. And it's like, you get dragged more for what you don't. Like, if you go, I support it, but if you don't put on the song and dance and go through the fucking, the pantomime of the routine for people, that's worse. Like, it's not bad enough to plead guilty. You got to, like, allocute in court. You got to admit you were part of the mafia. And what you know what I'm saying? You can't right. just be like, you know, I'm guilty of murder. No, well, me and Bobby and, you know, Vinny, we grabbed him. We chopped him up. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. you got to name names and dates and shit. So, yeah.
Well, kind of something I kept saying whenever I was trying to look this up, whenever we were talking, because I was trying to find what Kanye's tweets said. And I can't find anyone who's like just listing what the tweet said, but something that I keep seeing is that Adidas is under fire because they didn't drop him soon enough. So like dropping him wasn't good enough because they waited too long.
Well, it was 10% of their their sales. They held out as long as they could.
See, this is why that type of bullshit is dangerous, because we're teaching these companies that if there's any doubt, drop somebody, and like if you got it wrong, oh well, we'll figure it out later, because that will shut Twitter up immediately. You know what I'm saying? It's like, get out ahead of it.
Well, an example, like Tiger Woods quietly got like all of his sponsors back. Like how everybody dropped him, like, you know, 2009. Yeah, in the last like 10 plus years, most of them have quietly come back.
Shit, I'd say he got most of them back before 3 years had went by.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, like, as he should. I mean, like, because here's the thing. Like, I make golf balls and I pay Tiger Woods to endorse my golf balls, and that is, I see a spike in my sales every time a new ad in his ad campaign for me comes out.
Mm-hmm.
Man, have every Waffle House waitress tossing your salad between here and California. I don't give a fuck.
Right.
Just do the fucking ad and say the lines clearly. Mm. That's it. What do I care? Now, if you're like Tiger Woods for celibacy through Christ, okay, maybe you want to drop him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Rethink this marketing strategy here. I don't know. Let's rebrand here, you know?
It's Tiger Woods for Magnum condoms.
As the kids would say, this is problematic. Yeah. This is kind of a toxic relationship.
And everyone's like, oh, what's Kanye going to do for money? I think Kanye will be just us. I think this is, in a weird way, done Kanye a bit of a favor, at least as far as his music goes. Because now he don't need a middleman. He just put out an album now, go to KanyeWest.com, give me $10 to download my album, and I just keep the whole $10 now.
Well, that's... one of the podcasts that I was listening to, they were talking about that. That's one of the issues. What do you do about his music? Because for the uninitiated, take every Kanye West song that he fucking raps on or has any vocals. I don't care if he's just going, yeah, yeah. Like the corner from Common. Like he's just singing along with the verse.
Or what if he made the beat?
No. Because see,
Oh, sorry. I jumped ahead in the conversation.
Trying to jerk off on a chick's face during a gangbang. He just shot all over both of us.
I didn't hear this.
No, you're absolutely, but that's absolutely where I was going. To the normie, okay, you don't hear Kanye West's voice. Kanye West is off Spotify. Kanye West is off Google Music, Apple Music.
Actually,
whatever
not.
The fuck.
Spotify said we ain't pulling them.
Well, no. But what I'm saying is if that's what the fuck people want, they don't understand is that that man is a billionaire because when he puts out a song, outside of what, maybe a slice of publishing and distribution, that's a one-man operation almost.
Mm-hmm.
He can write, perform, produce. The only thing he's got to pay is sample rights, share his publishing if that's part of his record contract, and whatever he gets the chunk from his record company.
He don't even have a record contract. I'm saying now he can keep all the money.
So that's what he is doing now. And here's the thing. Do you think any record company who has a stake in keeping him on streaming services and keeping him on the radio and keeping those songs playing, who gets a cut? Just like he does, of the residuals, do you think they have any fucking interest in getting him off the radio? Fuck no. They want him streaming. They want, especially streaming, because they pay the artist shit on streaming.
Spotify even said, we pull an artist's music based on their content, not on their conduct. Spotify pretty much said, Spotify said his shit ain't going. Yeah, because, you know, billions of streams he gets.
That's what I'm saying. And you know what? I think it's like, was it 10,000 streams gets an artist a penny, the average artist a penny. And meanwhile, like the record companies are making like hundreds off of that. And like you think 10,000 streams, but you think of something like Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson probably does 10,000 streams worldwide in less than an hour. Easy. 7 billion people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting you brought up Michael Jackson. I feel like we're jumping all over here with Kanye stuff, but just, I don't think Kanye's as cooked as people think he is because of the black community. And my retort to back up my claim is Michael Jackson and R. Kelly.
Thriller.
Michael Jackson and R. Kelly. All right, we all know the Boondocks. Me and you at least know the Boondocks episode. He good! Dude, if black community's behind an artist, man, they don't give a shit. And this is not racism. I can back this up with sales figures. Michael Jackson is still considered a legend.
The white version of that is certain, I guess, country artists. Country country genres, like not like top 40, like with steel guitar bullshit. Like real country.
Oh, like 70s. No, there's a lot of wife beaters in old country.
Yeah, George Jones.
Yeah.
I mean, like, everybody remembers he stopped loving her today. No one remembers that he beat the dog shit out of his wife and he got pulled over running away on a tractor.
Yeah.
That was his great plan. Blackout drunk after beating his wife.
Yeah.
Run away on this tractor. And they're like, Mr. Jones, would you please get off the tractor?
Yeah.
Fuck you, motherfucker. Yes, Mr. Jones, we know who you are. Please get off the tractor.
Yeah.
That's a great video.
Kanye's going to have to lay low for a couple years and then reemerge all churchy.
Okay, I'm not worried. Well, first of all, I'm not worried about Kanye, period, one way or the other. But I don't think if you're weird and you are worried about Kanye's financial well-being, yeah. I think he's going to be all right. Even a Alex Jones type lawsuit and settlement would take years to get to that point. So he ain't looking at being on the street in the poorhouse or anything like that anytime soon.
Let's see.
As far as the public's attention span, he's a more beloved artist than Mel Gibson was a beloved actor and director. And we have a shorter attention span than we did 15, 16 years ago when Mel Gibson pulled his shit. I think Kanye could honestly have a comeback album and tour and within 5 calendar years, 5 years and one day be on a comeback fucking tour for his comeback album that's critically acclaimed. I think it could easily happen. Now, he can't fuck up, and he's got to shut the fuck up and get out of the spotlight and do everything right and listen to other people. So it's not very likely, but can it happen? It's possible. I do believe that. So, yeah, that's where I think what's going to happen with Kanye. I just don't know if he's smart enough to listen to anyone at this point that's going to tell him, you need to sit down and shut the fuck up.
And Kanye West has won 21 Grammys.
That really doesn't mean shit when you're burning every fucking bridge you have, dude. Those Grammys aren't going to fucking put food on the table. And he's not even finished with his divorce, and they haven't even begun to fucking divvy shit up over the kids. He's got... Then the fucking... Can you imagine the lawyer fees for those for that divorce?
Well, if they got married in California, they're each getting half of the others.
It still doesn't matter because once you enter kids... Everything's up for negotiation. That's what gets all these sports stars, man. It's 18% is the max they can take. Yeah. But it's all the other shit that you are stipulated you have to cover that kills a lot of people. It's not just a flat 18% of your paycheck goes to towards your kid. So, I mean, once again, is he going to be in a poorhouse? No.
He's from the suburbs. Maybe he's got a finance guy.
I mean, I'd hope so. But I'm just saying, like, Oof, I shudder to think about how much those lawyer fees are going to be and the court costs and everything when all is said and done. And that's if it just goes like an average divorce in Hollywood goes.
Well, it's allegedly there's just it's allegedly like, quote unquote, done. They're just still hammering out all the details.
Sure. I've seen too many divorces. I'm sorry. I've seen too many divorces, especially like right before. Clock strikes 12 and everything's done, where it's like, did you ever talk to a divorce lawyer? Did you see the shark that I told you to go see? Here's his business card. Just give him a call before. Yeah. And then they pick it up and they go, let me call this guy. And he's like, what? We can get you 15 million. Forget it.
Why you think I acted so quickly?
Absolutely.
Had to get that done before someone got in her ear.
Oh, it goes both ways. Trust me. Believe that, especially these days. But anyways, I think that's what he's going to have to do. I don't know if that's what he is going to do. I think what is interesting is that what we're seeing here, and this has nothing to do with Kanye besides he is the conduit that's showing us that this is capable. We're seeing a person be pretty much like deplatformed, depersoned in real time in at least the sense of pop culture. Now, if that means anything deeper than that, we'll see, because this is still tip of the spear with this type shit. I mean, I would say the first person that they really tried this on was Alex Jones.
Mm-hmm.
And I gotta say, it's been almost 5 years, and it's kind of worked, because if it wasn't for this fucking trial and that verdict, I haven't heard a lot about Alex Jones in the last 5 years in mainstream media. Like, that's how you know... That's how you know that mainstream media and the legacy media weren't really worried about Trump, because if they were and they thought he was dangerous, they just shut him up and never talked about him, because that's what they did to Alex Jones.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they do to pretty much anyone who.
But he's still around, selling his crazy shit.
But he doesn't get the extra spotlight. Free
he's
fucking
not getting the free pub.
Yes, like when Trump was elected, how'd this happen? Because all you fucking networks gave him $3 billion of free advertising. The man you supposedly hated, and it was worth ripping this country apart to
tell the truth. They're still trying. They're putting the January 6th trial on primetime television. All this shit.
By the way, I don't know.
They're raiding his club.
I saw it once again, edited clip. It's been a hell of a week. I get the feeling we've all had kind of a week. But I saw edited clips of a group interview. I don't know if you guys have seen this. And I don't know who was doing the interviewing and what group was being interviewed and why it was happening. But I get the sense that this reporter read these people that she was interviewing completely wrong. Because she goes into the interview and she's talking about January 6th, like, you know, all the people that died. And they're like, all the people, one person died. And it was one of the protesters that showed up. And they went down the list, you know, like of she was this, you know, everything that you guys supposedly fucking hold up, veteran, blah, blah, mother, blah, 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 this and that. Like, well, no, a police officer died. No, he had a stroke and he died a few days later.
Yeah.
Okay. That could have happened either way. You have no idea. You can't blame what was going on for his fucking stroke. The job made him have a stroke, then he shouldn't have been on the job. And It was just like, this reporter, it wasn't like this reporter was asking questions and these people were coming back and you could tell the reporter was like, I'm throwing these softballs because I want to start the argument. You could tell this reporter was fucking shook. It was like, whoa, whoa. Like, no, had no idea where to go with it. And then one of them was like, and they're like, well, she's like, well, don't you consider the insurrection, blah, 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 this and that. You know, and there's like, you know, insurrection, what were they really going to do, blah, 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 blah. And one guy was like, I'm more worried about Antifa. I'm more worried about the fact that I watched the country burn for a whole summer and no one's saying anything about that. And she goes, oh, so that makes what happened on January 6th okay? He's like, no, but why are we not hearing anything about that entire summer, but we hear about 3 hours on January 6th constantly? And I'm just like,
good question.
Out of the mouths of babes, people who are fucking country bumpkins, I guarantee we have looked behind the curtain of media enough to know how they fucking look at us unwashed plebs.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, yes, and that's exactly how they look at us. So
we're talking turds.
Yeah, this reporter was just like deer in headlights.
Welcome to the rest of the country, fuckface.
But yeah, and I'm just like, by the way, supposedly this is the face of extremism.
Yeah,
sadly,
get him.
That's just not a reality. But and that's not a sad thing. It's just a fact. It's not reality. That's the face of like most people. And by the way, even black people I know say that shit. So what are you gonna do? You can't call them white supremacists.
Oh no! Remember,
Candace Owens.
Remember Larry Elder in California was the black face of white supremacy, according to the LA Times.
And then Candace Owens, and yeah, then
Kanye,
and then the canvasser for Marco Rubio.
Hey, at least the white supremacist rallies now have some beats. It won't just be fucking, you know, country music and
but the
rock bands.
This was interesting. So the article, I sent it to the group chat. That was was that a Yahoo article? I'm trying to remember the source.
Perhaps.
I guess I can pull it up, right?
It was, Yahoo.
How often should I have to buy a new phone?
Like every 3 years?
Every year, ideally, to the phone company. The one that makes it.
Coming up on 3 years. This phone is getting to be a problem. I'm sorry, Jess, what did you say?
It was Yahoo.
Okay, I'm trying to pull it up. Okay, all right, here we go. Let's see if this will work. Okay, well, it's Jezebel reposted by Yahoo.
Oh, God.
And for the uninitiated, Jezebel is owned...
Man bad.
It's owned by the same people who do Kotaku and The Roots or The Root. And what's the other, the sports one that they were like, shut the fuck up and go back to?
Deadline or Deadspin?
Deadspin.
Isn't it Gawker Media or whatever?
Gawker, yes, Gawker Media.
So yeah, every article in Jezebel is man bad.
And intersectional from there, so you can extrapolate where they go with it, so. Anyways, I'm not going to go in and give this person. I won't assume their gender.
This is a woman. It's Jezebel.
I'm not going to assume that.
Oh,
non-binary female. Those exist.
Sorry, I'm a shitlord.
Because apparently this canvasser, this white supremacist, who hates himself, anybody who's not white and Christian, was out there canvassing for a first generation Cubano in Marco Rubio, because we all know Cubans are white and not at all Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
And that jibes with what the KKK and the Aryan Brotherhood believe,
white
right?
White supremacists love Hispanic people.
And Catholics.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just, I feel like this is an unofficial segment. Like once a week I see an article like this and I'm just like, oh, there it is. It's just complete bullshit. They're not even trying to hide the fucking bias. Like, this is... And you know when this shit started? This calling anyone who they disagree with politically or is to the right of them politically is a white supremacist. It started in Florida with Trayvon Martin and homeboy who shot him.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's true. I agree with that.
George Hernandez. Was that his name?
No.
Oh, I'm thinking George Hernandez. What is it? George Floyd and somebody Hernandez mixed up?
Oh, what was it?
George Zimmerman.
Zimmerman. Yes, he was a white. This is how they described him up here on the news. And I talked to my family in Florida when this was broadcast, and when I saw it online, I screenshotted it and everything. Zimmerman was described as a white Hispanic Jew, huh? And he's a white supremacist, neo-Nazi.
So he just took the white part and ran with it?
Make it make sense. That's all I can say. Like, I know it's a meme, and I know it's a cliche at this point, but is there for a reason? How does that even compute? But that, it once again, it doesn't matter. And you can go to Yahoo and article, Marco Rubio canvasser, a notorious white supremacist, was beaten in Miami area. I mean, it's flat out. You're fucking lying. Didn't Alex Jones just get sued out of fucking existence for this?
Because it went over the airwaves. This is on the internet. There's different laws. Section 203 or 230, baby.
You do understand that every piece of shit when we were growing up talked like that because they were pieces of shit and they were always like the garbage ones who were getting away with shit. Like, you know what I'm saying? The people who are fucking, who went after Alex Jones know damn well what loophole they're exploiting. It isn't just like, oh, we just accidentally didn't say anything where we can get sued. You know what I'm saying? Like, And believe me, behind the scenes, they want to keep it that way. Because, very good point. Why is this never brought up? Because every clip I see of Alex Jones saying anything, supposedly that he was sued and has a settlement against him for, are all from his online fucking show and his podcast. None of those are fucking broadcasts.
No, but they're syndicated. They were syndicated. It was back when he was syndicated over the radio.
So if it's syndicated over the radio, isn't it the radio station's responsibility to edit what they're fucking syndicating?
But if it goes over the airwaves, that's where... No, you don't sit there. You ever run a satellite feed? It's fucking someone making, like, minimum wage just...
Yeah, you're just board hopping, basically.
Yeah, they're not... It's when you go over the airwaves, that's when the libel and defamation laws apply. That's how they got them. Like, but that shit stays on the internet. That shit doesn't go out over the airwaves, so those laws don't apply to it. Dude, there's Section 230. That's the thing that makes websites not... That makes them not liable for the stuff that's published on their websites. That's what social media can hide behind. That's why you can go on social media, say some shit that's just wrong, and face no consequences. Section 230. That is what shields internet companies from the responsibility of what people post.
So instead of changing it to the same laws that and standards that would be people would be upheld to online that they would be if it went out over the airwaves, we just let the companies who run these social media sites decide what they're gonna allow.
Yep.
And what is mis or disinformation and what is truth. I'm just, you understand we are creating like a perfect petri dish for the most horrific dystopian future I can imagine, right?
Well, you know what their retort to that is? Well, we want to censor ourselves before the government has to step in.
Okay. That's like talking to someone who says 2 + 2 = fucking purple. I'm not going to waste my time.
But that's what they say. It's like, I'm just like, hey man, this is, if this is the new media, the same law should apply to you that apply to the rest of the media. You know, people shouldn't be allowed to just publish shit that's just wrong and get away with it. Like, no consequences at all. Like, that's why you can just, you talk mad shit about someone on social media and not you're nothing.
So wait a minute.
If you get a celebrity, you might get a C&D.
Hold on. So is that the loophole that gives like broadcast news stations the ability when they talk about like shit that's said online, they are just reporting about what's said online. They're not reporting what is said online as fact.
Bing 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 bing.
So
we're just saying what we saw on Twitter.
There's always a grift. There's always a loophole. I don't care. It does not matter what it is.
No, me and Aaron have been beating this drum on the Weedsman for years. Stop saying what a random bunch of assholes on Twitter is saying is a news story. Stop. It's not a news story. It's you're just saying your fucking intern that you went out to find you content fucking saw what's trending on Twitter and went, here you go. a handful of assholes and social media is not a new story.
And I agree with that. The problem is that I find most people, in my experience, personal anecdotal bullshit, not fucking peer-reviewed, gone through fucking Johns Hopkins experience. People that say that shit, they say that shit until it comes to something that they don't want that to be true about. It's and once again, it's, you know, when it's me, it's a different set of standards. So I don't know. It's, and I do remember us talking about it on Regimen more than a few times. I'd forgotten about that. Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of ingenious, man. It's kind of ingenious because shit, now we're all addicted to outrage clicks. We're addicted to fucking being pissed off. I mean, the first thing most people do, they say, they'll admit in like, you know, even polls where they give fucking names and shit and it's face to face, go to the comment section, look, start reading. Some people don't even like, I'm not going to say most, cause that would imply like the lion's share, but I'm going to say probably over 50% of people don't even read the story. They read the headline, scan the first paragraph or two, and then go down to the comment section. I would fucking put a lot of money on that. And if they've learned that they can fucking hide the truth behind fucking wordplay in the title and then in the first paragraph, then they can bury what, you know, they can be like, well, according to sources or what we saw on Twitter and an unofficial blah, 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 and get all the legal bullshit out the way. It's ingenious. It really is. Wow. I'm almost in awe of that. Like it's seriously, it's insidious to the point of like genius. It really is. Cause it's just blatant and it's hypocritical and it's like, don't give a fuck. I'm going to do this on Front Street. And you know what? You're going to cheer me on when I do it.
Yeah.
And it's the truth. Most people are like, oh, okay, this is the new news.
The Social Dilemma, man. They pretty much said that in it. Like, yep, you're going to tell us what you want to see.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Since 2013, Holosun has pushed the boundaries of innovation by manufacturing feature-packed red dot sights for sportsmen and professionals. Today, Holosun is proud to be at the forefront of technology with products that feature Shake Awake technology, our signature multi-reticle system, a 50,000-hour battery life, and our newest product, the SCS, where you never have to change your battery again. To learn more about the SCS and other Holosun innovations, head over to holosun.com.
Time to redo this basement?
Yeah, a home gym, movie theater, model train utopia.
Or yoga studio?
I'm flexible-ish.
Great. I'll just use the U.S. Bank mobile app so we can plan it out.
Which way are you leaning? Setting a savings goal or applying for a home improvement loan?
I say we look at both options. Right here in the app.
Budget for a really good home gym. We deserve it.
Noted.
Help for today, planning for tomorrow. That's what U.S. Bank is for. U.S. Bank. We'll get there together. Equal housing lender member FDIC.
Running a business is a lot of work. Luckily, I've got a great partner.
Oh, I thank you.
I meant U.S. Bank.
I knew that.
U.S. Bank Business Essentials is a huge help to us.
Totally. Their comprehensive point-of-sale system does it all. Tracks inventory, manages schedules, customizes orders.
Plus, all the regular banking stuff.
If only it could make coffee.
Nah, that's your job.
From point-of-sale to quick loans, we have many ways to make your business boom. That's what U.S. Bank is for. U.S. Bank. We'll get there together. Equal housing lender member FDIC.
Running a business is a lot of work. Luckily, I've got a great partner.
Oh, I thank you.
I meant U.S. Bank.
I knew that.
U.S. Bank Business Essentials is a huge help to us.
Totally. Their comprehensive point-of-sale system does it all. Tracks inventory, manages schedules, customizes orders.
Plus, all the regular banking stuff.
If only it could make coffee.
Nah, that's your job.
From point-of-sale to quick loans, we have many ways to make your business boom. That's what U.S. Bank is for. U.S. Bank. We'll get there together. Equal housing lender member FDIC.
Are you looking for a rewarding new career? The New Jersey courts are hiring. Make a difference doing work that matters. With competitive salaries, pension, benefits, on-the-job training, partial remote work, and paid holidays. Apply now at njcourts.gov/careers.
By now, you've probably seen ads about water contamination at Camp Lejeune everywhere on TV, social media, and probably even following you around on the internet. The water at Marine Corps Base Camp Lejeune was contaminated with toxic chemicals for more than 3 decades. It is not rare for people who drank this water for an extended period of time to develop severe illness, including kidney cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, leukemia, liver cancer, bladder cancer, birth defects, Parkinson's, and more. A new law called the PACT Act allows victims of poisoned water to seek repayment for their medical costs. What those other ads don't tell you is that because the PACT Act is a fresh law, it is important to find an attorney who understands the new claims forms. There is limited time to file your Camp Lejeune claim, so you need a lawyer who can get it right the first time. The experienced team of attorneys at sickmarine.com is ready to file your claim. They will fight for you and won't take no for an answer. To file your claim and to have your case prioritized, sign up at sickmarine.com.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
I'm going off the reservation, going a little rogue on this, but one of the things that I haven't dipped my toe into that I feel really guilty about not dipping my toe into before we did this show was every once in a great while, the few friends I have outside of the Western news and pop culture bubble will remind me that the world exists outside of that bubble. And like the rest of the world right now is like, you understand that Putin's over here talking about, like, you know, fucking detonating nuclear devices and shit like that, blah, blah, blah. And we're going over, like, okay, do we have the response shit in case this happens? And people are preparing for it in a very realistic, cold, calculated manner over there. And we're sitting over here, like just arguing about Kanye.
Yeah, we're mad at that a rapper said Jews run the media.
Yes. Something that almost every comedian set up until what, 2004, maybe 2005. And the ones with balls set it up until what, 2015, 2012, somewhere around there. So, yeah, I'm just blown away by it. It really is. It's genius. And it really is a way to keep us completely fucking in our own little bubble that where it's like, this is completely normal. And I'm just like, if we stepped out of our bubble for 5 seconds and lived in the world that I see these people talking about and I see pictures and video of, I think the average American would be crying for their mommy within about fucking 2 minutes, dude. I'm not even exaggerating. And that's just everyday life. And they're not even, dude, they're more like, they're annoyed because it's an inconvenience. If they came and were like, hi, we're the emergency broadcast system. There's a very good chance a nuclear device will be detonated within the city limits of Detroit, so you might want to prepare for it. There would be a fucking riot. Ohio would try to saw us off and fucking kick us into the fucking Great Lakes and be like, don't come back.
What are people? Biden's all up in my phone. Remember when it happened when they tested it with Trump? Like, why is Trump in my phone? What's he doing? We'd have it from the other side. Get out of my phone, Joe Biden. Sorry, just trying to tell you the bomb's coming.
But yeah, okay, sorry. Every once in a great while, I get a peek behind the curtain and of a different perspective. I mean, it's the same shit we see. It's just we see it here, and it's like, oh, that Russian stuff. Yeah, that was
March.
That was a couple months ago thing. New thing is what we really want you to get hyped for and put a fucking
anyone else
Facebook
concerned?
Profile picture up about.
Like two leaders of two world superpowers with very large arsenals, both losing it. Like, we got a front row seat for President Grandpa, but apparently Putin is sick and, like, dementia's setting in or some shit with whatever he's got. Apparently he's very unhinged.
I mean, I've been thinking that for a while just simply because, like, he seemed like a pretty fucking barely kept under wraps psychopath whatever in the first place. You know what I'm saying? Like,
mm-hmm.
He's got the history for it. He comes from the intelligence community, and I believe he was, like, doing wet work and good at it. That's how you excelled and climbed the ladder back then in Russia. So, if he's losing it and if he's got total power over there, at this point, I'm like, wow, I really hope Russia's got a bureaucratic bunch of bullshit like we do to the point where he's like, I woke up this morning and I didn't have a heart on. I want to nuke the Ukraine. They're like, that's nice, Vladdy. Go sit down. We'll put on fucking Orange is the New Black for you. You know, like, some, like, no, no, no. We got your warm milk and Murder, She Wrote fucking is on TV for you. Walker, Texas Rangers having a marathon. It's okay, Uncle Vladdy. Have a seat. So, yeah.
Well, it seems day to day over there anyways with this shit I read. There's some days I'm like, oh, like today I read, like, Zelensky's like, oh, we got good news coming. So who the fuck knows?
I don't even know what is going on, what is being negotiated. And I feel like we went from one extreme. Remember the Gulf War? Gulf War 1, not the sequel. Sequel really sucked.
The original starring Storm and Norman?
Yeah. You know, it's going to be another Vietnam. It wasn't even another Woodstock.
And the Scud Stud?
Yeah.
Arthur Kent?
The complaint was the American public got too much information from the media. That we were like we were accidentally, through the media, giving away our positions and secrets. So after 9/11, we went with the embedded journalist. So what you get was like Evan Wright. He was a freelance journalist, and he spent 3 months with the Marine Corps Recon, first Recon, tip of the spear into Iraq. Like they were the northernmost unit, American unit in Iraq for a lot of the invasion. And now it's just like, I don't even know what's being talked about. Like Gulf War One, like we knew, okay, so we have troops moving here, we're blanking off here, we're at the border here, we're at the border here. I felt like I was watching a game of Risk play out on TV. You know what I'm saying? And then like 2000, you know, post fucking 9/11, it was more vague. And you would, if you didn't go looking for the stories, a lot of the times the news reports were just vague. The true stories were stuff that come out 6 months, a year later, because they were, you know, basically novels or fucking long form fucking, you know, articles and shit. Now, like I said, it's just TikTok fucking videos. Yeah. That's not news. That's sound bites.
I saw a disturbing article the other day about the percentage of people who now get their news from TikTok.
Well, that's reliable.
Yeah. It's shocking. Get ready for this. It's mostly 18 to 24s, but there is a shocking amount of people our age, your age too, Jess, that get their news from TikTok.
And remember when people were like worried about people getting their news from Facebook?
Oh, yeah. And that seems like a quaint little memory.
Well, here's the thing. Why did no one flip out about people getting their news from Twitter? Because to post news links on Twitter is the exact same thing as to post news links on Facebook.
It's You're good just question.
Sharing the links because they were worried about who is sharing the link and what links were being shared. But that's beside the point. Just, I don't know. Just look around. Pay attention sometimes. See what happens. All right.
It's a great time. Great time to talk about some Elon and what we're going to be able to share on Twitter now.
Well, I know he went to Twitter HQ this week. What happened? We're to the point with him just arriving at Twitter HQ was a story.
He walked in with a kitchen sink. That was the story that I saw.
Okay, Mr. Eccentric Billionaire, why did he do that?
Well, the theory is that he's going to throw away or get rid of everything but the kitchen sink. They're saying that was the symbolism behind it.
So what are his plans for us to share and not share on Twitter? Or is that still all shrouded in secrecy?
That's all still very quiet. Just that it's going to not be censored. That's all I know about it. But I did see like everyone talking about the freaking him walking in with the sink.
Did he, forgive me if we have mentioned it on the show. If we mention it off air, I'm not going to remember it probably. But did he say when this initially came up about him buying Twitter, that if it went through, what he was going to do about Trump?
He said he'd reinstate him. He said he'd yeah.
Because I had a vague memory of like something like an olive branch was extended to Trump, and Trump was basically like, yeah, thank you. We have our own truth social media or whatever the fuck it is. And it was like, you know, basically like use it as an, you know, the thanks but no thanks, by the way, come check out my social media platform is what am I remembering that correctly? Or is it just,
no, that's correct.
Okay.
Ooh, Kanye bought Parler. Maybe Parler and Truth will team up. Kanye and Trump will get the band back together.
Yeah. So
Trump's is Truth. Kanye's is Parler. Who's Rumble?
Some Canadian company. They're from Canada. I know that.
Ooh. Resistance is born hard in Canada too. Unless you're coming from Western Canada, but that's another podcast. That's podcasting for less than two people.
Oh, you get the Eastern Canadians in. Oh, they've been all about leaving Quebec. Get them involved.
Well, once you get into French Canadian,
they've been trying to leave
French
for
Canadians
years.
Are different than, yeah. But you talk about like Toronto, Vancouver, very different than Alberta and Edmonton.
Oh, yeah. You know, Alberta and Edmonton is their fucking
great. Calgary and Edmonton, the Battle of Alberta, I should say.
Yeah. Like,
those are more.
That's country? Their Colorado and shit. That's their
Alberta. Midwest.
Yeah.
It's their Midwest. Thank you. Yes. You're going to see a lot of truck nuts probably in that area.
Yeah. A lot of horses, cows.
I just keep hearing stories. I don't know what you guys keep hearing, but I keep hearing stories about people who, once again, all secondhand. I'm not active on Twitter. I can't tell you for a fact this is true or not. But, I mean, we're talking people who measure their fucking followers in the thousands and are usually at least six figures as far as followers. And they're having fluctuations of, like, you know, 500 to a couple thousand on a daily basis, like followers coming and going. So I'm kind of wondering if there's like a purge going on, or not a purge, but kind of like a checkup on accounts, and like if your account's been idle, if you haven't logged in.
I read this week Twitter is hemorrhaging active users, like which is basically the 10%. It's the same stat we've heard, like the 10% of the Twitter users are responsible for 90% of the tweets. And those people are going away. And all of the things that people have traditionally been searching for on Twitter since the pandemic have changed. It's gone to all like NS, not safe for work, and crypto since the pandemic.
I mean, I guess the crypto stuff makes sense.
I mean, and you don't think this is a coincidence? After we hear that they purge all the bots, now we're hearing active users are going away? I don't think that's coincidence.
Elon did fire the CEO and two other top executives, just as a sidebar.
Oh, the guy who took over for Jack Dorsey's already been shit-canned?
Yep.
See, but that makes me, like, I mean, I get it if you have a beef with the way the people who are running Twitter, or the way Twitter's been run recently. I understand you can take a victory lap for that, but the more fucking cold business minded side of me, the little bit that does exist, is just like, that's not shocking. That's not even out of like character for someone who comes in and buys a company to be like, okay, I'm cleaning house, I want to bring in all my own people.
Yeah.
I mean, you bring in
your own team.
Yeah. You get new regional heads and they'll fucking clean house as far as like store managers or whatever, you know, in smaller companies. So I mean, something like Twitter, where it's not just I want to bring in my own team, but it's there very well could be like ideological conflicts that would affect the ability to work together.
I'll make Trump the CEO of Twitter. Do it, Elon.
I'm just saying, I think Musk is going to be like, well, here's the deal. I'm Elon Musk and you're not, so you go find right. another job, because I'm not gonna waste, motherfucker, I don't care you work for Twitter, I ain't gonna argue with you like we're on Twitter.
Hey, Elon gets shit done. Like, have whatever opinion you want about him, he gets shit done.
Yeah,
bring back 45, let's do it.
Rip the band-aid off, see what happens.
So make him the president of Twitter. I'm back. Twitter's going to be better than ever.
Oh, God.
Was there anything else for Twitter?
No. That was literally, that's all I've seen about it.
Well, I mean, I sent you guys the article about The Rock, and I think he was tweeting out about Black Adam, wasn't he?
Yes.
Like, those were mostly tweets that they had screenshots of.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See, that's how I remember show subjects when I'm too lazy to write them down on a piece of paper. It's in front of me in the pad. But I'm Johnny Mnemonic over here. Rock took to Twitter this week. I mean, Black Adam opened up. I think it's the number one movie in the nation rather easily. Mm-hmm.
It's The Rock's best opening ever.
Did it do over 100 mil?
I don't have that exact figure in front of me.
The story I heard is that it opened pretty much on par with the Shazam movie, which is like one of the like Suicide Squad B-level DC movies.
Mm-hmm.
And that Shazam movie, I think, did $500 million, but it also cost like a third of what Black Adam cost. So if Black Adam only does $500 million, that's a big failure. But it's being praised by the fans, and The Rock being The Rock, which, I mean, I got to wonder how much of this comes from him coming from wrestling and having to play to crowds and read the room. The Rock has went the opposite way of what Hollywood's been doing for the last 5-6 years.
$67 million opening weekend.
Okay.
For post-pandemic, I guess that's great.
Okay. So, yeah, he actually took to Twitter and started, like, praising, like, thanking the fans. And he was like, basically, look, it's nice if they like it, but they don't buy tickets. Yeah. And it's just that was the default setting for most things growing up when we were kids, right? I mean, like,
remember Michael Jordan? Conservatives buy tennis shoes too.
Well, I mean,
their sneakers or whatever you call them.
Just try to keep it in the realm of fucking movies. Like the action stars in the '80s, they were not critical darlings. Nobody thought Stallone or Schwarzenegger were, or definitely Steven Seagal or Van Damme were acting giants.
Those movies were critically were panned. They were considered pieces of shit, made money.
At some point in the '90s, the cynical, like, kind of like attitude that came with the '90s gave us like those same action heroes kind of going, "Oh, we get it. We're not critical darlings, but we're still going to make big, dumb fucking movies that are fun." And that's how you ended up with, like, True Lies.
Oh, yeah. I was just about to say, True Lies is a good-ass movie.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And it's a James Cameron movie.
Some of the best ways to kill a fucking villain ever. Spoiler alert, 30 years old, fires him, gets his backpack caught on a fucking missile and fires a missile in the building. It's fucking great.
But yeah, and it was, like, somewhere in the 2000s, action movies fell out of, you know, favor with Hollywood. Fine, whatever. Shit comes, shit goes. Westerns come, you know, horror movies.
Oh.
Genres come, genres go. They have peaks and valleys.
But then in the 2000s, Vin Diesel rode in.
But it's like these fucking, like, pathetic, whiny action heroes. Like Statham? Yeah. You know, the guy from Cranked?
Like, nothing he ever did was whiny.
He's about the only guy I'm thinking of, but he's not American. Like, Vin Diesel, I've seen him in interviews, and I'm like, you're kind of a bitch, dude.
Yeah, but they're on, like, 10 Fast and Furious movies. Them bitches make money.
I know, but, like look at everyone in the Fast. Just stay with that franchise. Paul Walker. Hey, you're good looking, bro. Well, at least you were before you hit that tree. But
no, but those movies know what they are. Dude, you... Aaron loves those movies. A person who I would think would be on the bottom of the list.
But it's almost like they
loves
make,
those people love those movies for some reason.
It's I don't know how to explain it. Like, it's he's like, we made a movie that is true to the characters, true to the source material, and the critics don't like it, yet the fans, who the only shot this movie was gonna have, because by the way, let me ask two non-comic book nerds here. Jess, Chris. Had either of you heard of Black Adam before this movie?
No.
I mean, even at all?
No.
No.
Okay, let me try to expand out and see if I can catch you guys in a little web here. Had you heard of Captain Marvel? Not the Brie Larson movie.
No. But
the guy who was in the movie Shazam.
Actually, I had heard about him, and I had not heard about the other Captain Marvel.
Okay. All right.
Like, yeah. I knew about that Captain Marvel. I did not know about the Brie Larson Captain Marvel.
I'm still a no.
Okay. Which would make sense because...
She's a no on all fronts.
Well, it makes sense because that Captain Marvel, I think they had to change, and that's why it's like Shazam now or whatever the fuck. I don't know. Lawsuits involved. But that's what I'm saying. Like, he fought to get this movie made. This is kind of his version of what Ryan Reynolds did for Deadpool. And if you notice, like, Deadpool, I think, post... 2000s X-Men. It was the first fucking superhero movie that was rated R.
Yes.
I mean, Blade, if you really go back, but how many people realize Blade was a superhero movie? I don't think many people who were
black people.
Well, I mean, Shaft is a superhero movie by, like, the dictionary definition of it. He's got an origin story. He's got a main villain.
Yeah.
He's almost got superpowers because he's a lot of ass. Motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So, yeah. But yeah, I
he's
do think
complicated
it's,
man.
I do think it's funny that he's taking victory laps like he is. And I think he's going to get away with it because he's The Rock. And The Rock is in that rare air with like Ryan Reynolds, where I don't think anything he's done has ever really stuck to him. He's gotten kind of caught up a few times by association. Like, for example, the Joe Rogan N-word controversy, because he had been on Joe Rogan and he defended Joe Rogan.
Ooh, The Rock?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they were like, on Twitter, of course, have you seen this video? And he's like, well, you know, that's unfortunate and blah, 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 blah. And it was like we were talking about earlier. He didn't condemn Joe Rogan enough.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's what they were taking him to task for. Besides that, what's he ever really been stuck with?
No, he's got a good public image. He's got a good PR team, or he's actually maybe also a decent dude. Maybe it's probably Lil Column A, Lil Column B.
I think he's for Hollywood. I think he's like Chris Pratt. I think he's a Hollywood conservative, which means he's a liberal anywhere else in this country.
It's true. You really don't know if The Rock steps into a voting booth, you really don't know where he's voting. And generally, when you run into those people in Hollywood, they're conservative. And it makes sense. Isn't he from Florida? I'm playing my 2022 card. He's playing an Arabic person. He's not Arabic. I want him canceled. That movie is not about a Samoan. It's about an Arabic person. Actor could have taken that role.
Someone went all "It's a Huey Freeman Christmas" to rationalize this on Reddit. I just saw the screenshots. I couldn't find the fuck. I think that the actual discussion had been deleted. But they're like, okay, first of all, Black Adam is Egyptian, and The Rock is part blah 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 blah. And Egyptians back then, blah 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 blah, resembled more the Moors.
That bitch is from Samoa.
They were people who would be considered black and people of color in today's societal standards, and so is The Rock, so it's okay for The Rock to play the person.
Egypt and Samoa aren't near each other, bitch.
I'm like, that's like saying an Irish person can play a person from Britain and they don't even need to change their accent or nothing. That doesn't even, you just lumped all black people or people who are darker than white people in as the same.
Bitch, I'm gonna show you the Middle East and Samoa on a map. They're nowhere near each other. I bet the slave routes were much different. But anyway.
Well, weren't there like parts of Northern Africa that profited hugely off of the fucking slave trade?
Oh, yeah.
And like to this day, there's still parts of Northern Africa that are countries that are slavery is acting to this day happening like it's cool. And I'm not talking like China slave labor. I'm talking like real slave labor, like we think of slave labor.
Yeah.
Like well, you can pick it or I can kill you. That's your choice. I mean, you know.
But you know what? I think that you're getting at the wrestling, and I'm, you know, tongue's a little in cheek here, but I mean, if you look at Rotten Tomatoes, it's like 90-something% with the people, right? He was the people's champion. Just say it. That was part of his image. He's always about the people.
I'm telling you, he's leaning into it, and he's playing up into it, and it goes back to something we talk about a lot on this show. I talk about and bring up a lot on this show. Hollywood and the gatekeepers for culture and whatever in this country obviously need someone on the artistic side to show them that, like, hey, all this money you're chasing because of these Twitter twats, it ain't real. These people aren't going to buy your product. But guess what? Joe Sixpack loves us.
Like, didn't Top Gun prove that this summer?
It's going to be one of the biggest films in the history
ever
of the world.
Yeah. Like, ever made.
Like, that's not a prediction. That's not a bold statement. That's just a cold, hard fucking fact at this point.
And you can stop your internal dialogue. No, worldwide. Worldwide.
Bingo.
Why? Not just in America in our tiny little bubble where we think we're awesome. The whole world loved this movie.
I still don't know why. I mean, like, I watched it. I was like,
no, because but you know what? It's because you know why? Because for 2 hours, you don't think about any dumb bullshit. You just probably think about the movie. Yeah, planes and shit.
She like, blew it up real good.
Yeah, like, that's probably why. It's serving the purpose of what a movie's supposed to do. You're disconnecting from reality for 2 hours and being entertained.
No, I get it. I get it. And it's made in the inoffensive way that, sadly, I used to consider Milk Toast Like, if Hollywood made, like, in the 90s, put out some, like, even though I like the movie for what it is, I don't think it's as great a movie as everybody makes it out to be. Like, Forrest Gump. Forrest Gump is, like, Forrest Gump is the skim milk of fucking entertainment.
Have you seen it recently? Like, have you seen it, like, the last 10 years-ish, 10, 15?
Oh, for sure, last 10 years.
It doesn't hold up. I don't think it holds up.
Okay, but... What? Okay, but hold on. We'll get to it, because... Fuck it. What doesn't hold up about Forrest Gump? Because I'm trying to, like, what? The effects?
That part of it. But just, like, maybe I'm older and I'm more cynical. Just, the story seemed ludicrous. Like, watching it as an adult versus, like, when I was a teenager and it came out.
I always thought the story was, like, I always took it as supposed to be, like, a...
Like, I get it.
A it's baby like, boomer fairy tale. Like, but I didn't think baby boomer fairy like, tale. I just thought, it. Like,
it's along the lines of
parents' generation of, fairy tale.
Of the George Bailey story with the you never know the effect just one person can have. Like, I get what they're trying to do. Right? But I guess, like, all of these, he just happened to be there for all of these huge events in history. Like, just, like I said, like, as an adult and not a 16-year-old, just some of it just seemed a little far-fetched. Like if somebody brought it to a studio now, they'd be like, "All right, Pollyanna, let's take this back. Like, you got something here, but let's."
Are you kidding? They'd be like, "Okay, first of all, it's gonna be Farista Gump,
right?
You're gonna be
non-binary,
immigrant. Yep, exact." Oh, yeah, and have no flaws whatsoever, which is like if you find flaws with Forrest Gump, you're really looking. But they'll find flaws with Forrest Gump and be like, our character, this non-binary blah, 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 has to be perfect right out the gate. And it's like, well, so why am I watching a movie? What's interesting about watching a perfect person go through life? In fact, that sounds like a good way to infuriate myself. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. Just watch someone be perfect at everything the first time they try it. And I'm just like, do you know how many fucking years I spent cross-legged on my bed learning to play guitar, and this fucker can just pick it up and whip out some Yingvay? Yeah. Fuck you, cocksucker. You know what I'm saying? So Hollywood's, yes, disconnect, absolutely. And I think that is what Hollywood wish fulfillment is the biggest, and the let's put it this way, the glossing over of the more nuanced parts of history that were covered in Forrest Gump, I think, is that movie's biggest sense.
Yeah, that too. Like, a lot of, yeah, like, just as a history buff, a lot of, like, things is, yeah, that's cool, and then, like, no, that's kind of not how that happened, or stuff like that, like, or too, like, I get it, it's a movie about a dude who didn't exist, but, like, it's, like, but, this whole golden retard theory, like, it's just, that's really kind of what I took from it as an adult, like, I don't know, that's, I just...
You play gay, you get the Oscar. You got to suck the cock, or you got to not know what to do with your cock, and you'll get an Oscar. That's what's up.
No, like, it's... Like how people talk, the magic Negro. Like, I felt that's kind of what they were doing to Forrest Gump, like, with retarded people, or mentally challenged people.
The,
like,
happy tard?
Yeah, like, he just lucked into all this stuff.
Like, but here's the thing. We all know Forrest Gump. He works at, like, Banana Republic folding shirts. Like, or he's the guy constantly cleaning the same window at McDonald's every time you go past. You know what I'm saying? Like, we all know Forrest Gump. It's just, in this movie, Forrest Gump, just right place, right time, to the point of, motherfucker, you bought Apple for pennies. You bought Apple stock for pennies.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
Come on. Yeah. No, I got you. I don't even know where I was, but we just shit on Forrest Gump. Like, and I wasn't even trying to defend Forrest Gump, because it's just a dumb movie.
I shit on Forrest.
No, you brought me around.
Hate mail comes to me.
No, hate and discontent is raining down from my angry balloon knot as well on that movie now. So, yes, you've brought me around to shitting on it. Congratulations. That doesn't happen very often in real time. If you rewind that, you will, like, if you run it back, I'm kind of half-assed, like, oh, come on. Then I'm like... Yeah, kick it while it's down, bitch. That's what you get for coming out here with killers.
Take a socks.
Take Forrest Gump's socks. Mama ain't saying shit about shit now, huh? Yeah. Oh, God. Okay, fuck it. Jess, pick a topic. We don't even care. We got to pivot to something. So we might as well just jump into the deep end.
Let's go the Boston University COVID mice thing. Just to throw that one out there. I can explain that better. My apologies. That's how I have it written down, truly, on my notes.
See, I would just file this under, are you fucking kidding me? Did we not learn anything from the previous almost 3 years? But I'll let you take it from there.
So, no, I keep seeing this headline go around. So I did my own little deep dive on it because I was going to send it to the chat. And I was like, well, let's see what this actually means, right? So the way that, this is being spun by most people is that scientists at a lab in Boston University made a version of coronavirus that was 80% lethal to mice. Like, just period. That's where they ended. They're calling it gain of function research, all this stuff. And there is some controversy behind it. There's the NIH has had something to say about it, saying that these people at Boston University didn't have the authority to be manipulating the virus. Boston University says that they did and that it's not gain of function. It's a back and forth. But whenever you can get past all the sensational headlines of everything, what actually happened is the scientists were experimenting with the COVID vaccine, or not vaccine, the COVID virus. And they were testing to see if making the COVID virus have more spikes is what was making it more lethal. Like, if the more spikes a COVID virus had on it, if it was going to be more lethal. So they combined, I think it was Omicron and the original Wuhan strand, and they made it more spiky, and it killed 80% of the mice. What they're leaving out of that is that at whatever concentration they were giving this to the mice, the original Wuhan strand killed 100% of the mice. So they're not making this hyper deadly COVID virus to go drop a vial outside and get all of us sick and amp up the vaccine program and whatever else people want to say about it.
They made weaker COVID.
Yes.
Well, I remember seeing Boston. It was funny. There was a blip, and it was a blip in the news cycle. Boston University came out and actually said, that's kind of not what we're doing. But the more sensational headline is kind of what you were getting. Oh, they're making super COVID.
Yes.
Okay, so I'll take the hit for fucking, because immediately, you know, reading the article, reading it, you know, all that, I'm like, oh yeah, this will end well.
Well,
so I'll take the hit, but I still want to say this. Whether or not we get something useful out of this, here's my concern.
Godzilla.
We have fucking real world proof going on 3 years that they can fuck around with this type of shit, possibly through their own fuckery or incompetence, release it, and then just be like, yeah, it's crazy. And then ruin people's lives, careers, destroy families, businesses, because people are going, did it leak from a lab? That's disinformation. You're deplatformed. This and this and it. You see what I'm getting at?
Yes, repeat cycle.
Yes.
And here we are again. Yes.
That's
absolutely. And I do, I don't think.
Oh, and by the way, I'm sorry, Jess. I know I'm interrupting. I'm sorry, but I just want to say this real quick. My concern is they do it with no responsibility. Their feet not held to the fire. That's my concern.
Well, hey, we get rid of Section 230. That goes away.
I'm sorry. So what were you saying?
No, I disagree with them fucking around with it. What if, because this was just the outcome, right? Like, the outcome ended up being that it was less virulent than the original Wuhan strand. But what if it wasn't? That's another question. You know, like, everyone's like, and I even had this moment of like, ooh, okay, well, it's not as bad. We're fine. And then I'm like, no, I don't like that because they're still over here just fucking around with it. And
how do you think vaccines are made? How do you think they come up with medicine?
Well, I mean, from the last 3 years, my assumption is they guess.
Well, I actually heard some stuff today. No, actually, in the last 3 years is they... oh, boy. I don't want... Can of worms here. But no, they skipped... they shortened their test by, 11 years and 6 months, for starters. No, they skipped a lot of steps is what they did. But no, but I guess what I'm getting at is what they're doing now is they're still, like, this is like the process of, like, medicine. How do you figure out how to combat things? You got to experiment with them. Like, it's like what you said, they made weaker COVID. Like, we all know less people died from Omicron, right? So they like, hey, let's mix Omicron together with the Wuhan and see why that happened, right? Let's see why 80% of the mice died as opposed to 100% of the mice. Like, isn't that science? Aren't we officially talking about fucking around and finding out?
So, yeah, I see what you're saying, but it wasn't approved. It wasn't approved by the NIH. It wasn't for vaccine-related studies. Things like this need to have a plan, not just, let's just throw some shit in a petri dish, see what happens, so we can go, ooh,
wasn't it cool. Just called, well, isn't it called research? And what they do?
If it's approved, the big debate right now is it gain of function? Because they are trying to see if they could make it more virulent. Now, they're saying they were trying to figure out what was making it virulent, but what if it had? What if it had made it more contagious, more likely for us to get it?
Unless it got out, what if? I mean, there's probably tons of shit sitting in labs we don't want to know about.
I mean, you're not wrong, but how many things that have shut down a world and fucked up an economy and destroyed livelihoods?
And see, I think that's where my problem lies right there, is because where is the accountability for it? I don't need a sacrificial lamb to be paraded out and we all fucking, you know, do them like they did Mussolini after World War II. I don't need that. I want a corporation who was like, yeah, we skimped on safety measures and this is the end result the last 3 years. You no longer exist and everybody's going to prison. And you ain't going to nice prison. We're sending you to the prison that you don't want to go to, filled with the people that you drive through their neighborhood with your doors locked and your windows rolled up. That's what I want. That's my concern, because we've already proven time and time again in my lifetime, that type of fuck up goes unpunished. So if you're going to fuck around with this shit under the pretense of we're trying to find out how to make better vaccines or to fight it better, okay, cool. But you also, to whom much is given, much is expected. We're giving you a lot of responsibility doing this. You fuck up on your watch, that's your ass.
Well, yeah.
One strike policy applies, but we don't have that in this situation. We don't. That's my problem. That's my concern with this.
Before we start experimenting around with more COVID, right? Should the CDC not maybe take a minute to regroup? Have a little phone call with the FDA and the NIH and everyone, just like have a little conversation, because of how terribly things have been mishandled so badly, they've had to admit it. Like, that should tell everyone what they need to know. The director of the CDC had to say, like, this was mishandled.
That was so, like, 3 months ago, Jess?
That was not 3 months ago. That was in conversation about them having to admit that the frickin' vaccine doesn't stop transmission.
Remember when grandma died in a nursing home by herself, surrounded by strangers, and you couldn't talk to her? That was like so 2 years ago. Like, just get over it. Let's move on. Come on. Oh, God.
Yeah, we're on to the next thing, okay? Transgender.
What did Kanye say about something? I don't know. How about that?
But no, I mean, it's a big deal, and they need to stop just screwing around without any level of accountability. There's still no accountability to anyone for the last, let's say, year and a half since the vaccines rolled out and since people were losing their jobs. And now the freaking in New York, the nurses and the employees who got fired for not being vaccinated, they all are getting their jobs back.
And back pay.
Yeah.
And for everyone doing a victory lap, I understand how you feel, but let me just say this. Where the fuck you think that cost is getting passed on to? It's not going to eat into their profits.
Exactly.
The medical field ain't going to take a cut to their profits.
Yeah. Well, maybe that's why they're raising the cost of the COVID vaccine times four. Did you see that?
I mean, here's the thing. Fine, you're a business. You have to grow by 0.0001% every quarter or else you die. Whatever the fuck you've convinced yourself of. Fine. Can't you just have an income stream you've milked dry and go, we're done with this one. Put the COVID fucking vaccine away.
Why?
What? How? Why do you have to keep trying to fucking milk it?
Because if it's the, I'm saying this is the mindset. Because the money's still rolling in. Why would you stop it?
People are dying from this fucking vaccine. That's why you stop it.
Okay. We're starting another conversation.
But what
you asked?
Where? But
where the numbers?
Where are the
what numbers? I'll present them.
Where are the body counts?
Where are the you want to talk the
from the vaccine? I want vaccine body counts.
Are we only talking deaths, or can we just talk? Can we talk?
You said people. You said people are dying from the vaccine.
Okay, I will present. I will come to you with an argument by next week.
So, once again, whatever it doesn't. I sorry, I lost my train of thought. Sorry. Because I'm just like, okay. I just don't understand. Like, I can understand maybe, like, coming up with, we're going to do this like a flu vaccine. We're going to have, like, what is it?
Yeah, once a year.
What is it? Like, 3-4 different variants they have vaccines for. They decide which one is going to be the, or they try to predict which one's going to be the bad one this year. That's your flu vaccine. Old people with high risk and paranoid fucking people and hypochondriacs are going to be the ones that get it all the time. Just treat the COVID. That's steady income for doing nothing. But you got to get greedy and raise the price by 4 times. Hey. And you know the government's paying for it. So who's really paying for it?
Us, hey, Chris Rock, baby. Remember? The money ain't in the treatment. The money's in the medicine.
No, I absolutely get what you're saying and agree with that. Once again, no, the government isn't paying for shit. The government doesn't pay for anything. They don't produce capital.
No, they just
take
it from
ours.
Us.
Yes. Is this what you want your fucking money spent on? Yes or no? Argue about the fucking bullshit later. Get lost in the weeds looking for the ball later. So yeah. That's bullshit. And any politician, if you still believe in voting, why are you voting for, and that pisses you off, any politician who signed off on that, why are you voting for them? No matter what their fucking letter after their name is. I think that's a fair question, never gets answered by anybody, because they run back to their ideological corners and go back to their fucking tribe.
I do think it's coincidental Pfizer just keeps coming up with it. You're going to need like a series of 4 shots. Oh, now we need 4. Okay. And they just keep, because they got the blank check book from the government. Yeah, everyone needs 4 shots now. Here, we'll buy enough
for everyone. That's what I'm saying. That's basic fucking, basic like fairy tales we tell our kids, like parables about life. Like, don't get too greedy because you can fuck yourself over. They got the goose that laid the golden egg and they're kicking the motherfucker because they're like, you only lay 5 a day. We want 6.
Yeah.
Motherfucker, at what point? Okay, we are civilized here. You go to whatever countries, other countries, and do this shit, they'll start hacking body parts off with machetes. You start fucking over entire villages and fucking warlords who run these fucking warlord-sized nation states.
Yeah, I learned something today that I did
go
not
pull
know.
Pull that shit there.
Did you know that the United States is one of only 2 countries on the planet that can advertise, where drug companies can advertise on TV?
I've never understood. Why the fuck do I need to advertise on TV? If I need a medication, I'll go to my doctor. He'll tell me what I need.
Right?
Why do I need to be advertised to?
1997. Law changed. I don't know.
I mean, here's the deal. The first ads I really remember being like, wow, these are a little ridiculous, was Viagra.
Dick pills. Holding hands in the bathtub.
And I'm just like, believe me, the minute they made a pill that made old men's dick get hard, everybody who needed to know about it knew about it within like a week. And this was like before the internet was the internet.
Right, yeah.
It's still good news travels fast when motherfuckers yes. can use their dick again. For our dickless listeners, whatever gender you may identify as, trust us dick Dick full genders? Dick holding genders? Dick owning genders?
Person with penis? No.
Penis holders?
Yeah, right. Well, that sounds like I hold penises.
I mean, at least my own. Yeah, I mean, true. I just don't let it fly when I take a piss. True. Yeah, anyways.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Running a business is a lot of work. Luckily, I've got a great partner.
Oh, I thank you.
I meant U.S. Bank.
I knew that.
U.S. Bank Business Essentials is a huge help to us.
Totally. Their comprehensive point-of-sale system does it all. Tracks inventory, manages schedules, customizes orders.
Plus, all the regular banking stuff.
If only it could make coffee.
Nah, that's your job.
From point-of-sale to quick loans, we have many ways to make your business boom. That's what U.S. Bank is for. U.S. Bank. We'll get there together. Equal housing lender member FDIC.
Are you looking for a rewarding new career? The New Jersey courts are hiring. Make a difference doing work that matters. With competitive salaries, pension, benefits, on-the-job training, partial remote work, and paid holidays. Apply now at njcourts.gov/careers.
By now, you've probably seen ads about water contamination at Camp Lejeune everywhere on TV, social media, and probably even following you around on the internet. The water at Marine Corps Base Camp Lejeune was contaminated with toxic chemicals for more than 3 decades. It is not rare for people who drank this water for an extended period of time to develop severe illness, including kidney cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, leukemia, liver cancer, bladder cancer, birth defects, Parkinson's, and more. A new law called the PACT Act allows victims of poisoned water to seek repayment for their medical costs. What those other ads don't tell you is that because the PACT Act is a fresh law, it is important to find an attorney who understands the new claims forms. There is limited time to file your Camp Lejeune claim, so you need a lawyer who can get it right the first time. The experienced team of attorneys at sickmarine.com is ready to file your claim. They will fight for you and won't take no for an answer. To file your claim and to have your case prioritized, sign up at sickmarine.com. By now, you've probably seen ads about water contamination at Camp Lejeune everywhere on TV, social media, and probably even following you around on the internet. The water at Marine Corps Base Camp Lejeune was contaminated with toxic chemicals for more than 3 decades. It is not rare for people who drank this water for an extended period of time to develop severe illness, including kidney cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, leukemia, liver cancer, bladder cancer, birth defects, Parkinson's, and more. A new law called the PACT Act allows victims of poisoned water to seek repayment for their medical costs. What those other ads don't tell you is that because the PACT Act is a fresh law, it is important to find an attorney who understands the new claims forms. There is limited time to file your Camp Lejeune claim, so you need a lawyer who can get it right the first time. The experienced team of attorneys at sickmarine.com is ready to file your claim. They will fight for you and won't take no for an answer. To file your claim and to have your case prioritized, sign up at sickmarine.com.
Has winning lost its luster? If you or someone you know suffers from a gambling disorder, help is available at 800gambler.org. Today is the day to help yourself or a loved one get their life back. Not getting help means losing time with family, friends, life events, and sometimes even more. Go to 800gambler.org or call 1-800-GAMBLER. Treatment is confidential and works. Have a gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. We answer 24/7, 365.
ShopRite's locked in price. What is it? It's locked in prices on all your favorite products. It's dependable, like cookies and milk. It's reliable, like hot cocoa on a chilly day. Because in a crazy world, we figured you could use a little more constant. When we hold prices, you shop with confidence. Look for the locked-in price icon in-store and online at ShopRite.com and start saving today. ShopRite, helping you get it together, together.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
Okay, I would like to circle this back real quick.
Yes. We can get off dicks flopping around unhandled.
The whole reason, because when you posted that in the chat about the Boston University with the COVID and the 80% death rate in mice, I was going to reply to you about it, but I'm not really trying to like set you up about it, but I wanted to hear like your thoughts on air about what I knew about that, because I had done the deep dive. And it goes straight back to that whole conversation we were having about not being able to trust the fucking media. You can't trust shit, no matter what side you're on. Everything's sensational, because that's all that was being touted around by pretty reputable sources. I know Tim Cass talked about that one. I know Tim Cass talked about that one, about how they were making COVID, you know, 80% fatality. And that was whenever it was first coming out. And I understand you got to talk about stuff quickly as it's coming out. But it wasn't that. It's all just, you know, it's just sensational just to get people talking about it instead of giving a real story.
Got
to
click first.
Yes.
Got to be the originator. Got to churn out content.
I mean, my take on that is, one, yeah, that's the media. I mean, we've talked about them. I talk about them quite a bit on this show. I know Chris has brought them up quite a bit, but one of the first teachers that we had in the broadcast school we met in was a gentleman named Dick Kernan. And one of the first things he taught you was there's two sayings you've heard that some of you think are cliche or corny or whatever, but they're real and they're true, and you got to get it through your head or else you're in the wrong business. And that's, if it bleeds, it leads, and sex sells. And yeah, that's nothing new. And I mean, we've dumbed it. We've dumbed down how we deliver news, how we consume news, to a point where it's, I swear to God, we're at a kindergarten level. Like, the newspaper 50 years ago, I believe, was written at the average newspaper was written at the third grade level for the average American. We should be at, like, what, sixth, ninth for the average American now? I bet you we're written lower than the third grade level.
Oh, there's typos and news stories from, like, reputable organizations.
Take all those out. Like, I'm just talking about, like, how you would write. I can't write War and Peace for a 5-year-old, but I can write See Dick Run for a 5-year-old. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what I'm talking about.
I was reading a story from CBS the other day that had a thing at the bottom said, report typos and corrections here. And there's somebody's job it is to read this bitch before you even publish it?
Yeah.
Editor.
Okay, so you want me to proofread?
Used to be two people, editor and a proofreader.
And a fact checker, which would kind of half-assed sort of do the job of, kind of overlap, like a Venn diagram. There was some overlapping there. But yeah, so not only do you want me to pay for your news, like,
and now it work for you?
Now you want me to edit it for you, yeah, too? Is there anything else? Can I get you coffee? Your feet a little sore? You want them rubbed there, sir?
Right.
What the fuck is this shit?
But
that's my take. And I mean, you couple that with the click is God. Click is God. Interaction is God. I mean, this is the honest to God's truth. I got into a conversation with someone online who was wanting to start a podcast / video simulcast. I don't know what you would call that. But, and I guess he'd Facebook stalked me or something and saw that I had been on, you know, I got one of the podcasts listed in something somewhere, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. He started asking me questions, and I'm like, I don't know, blah, 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 blah. Here's the deal. And I told him everything, like, you know, you can pretty much get started. And I gave him my setup, which wasn't a professional setup, but we used for fucking the better part of a decade via Skype. And he's like, yeah, but how do I get people to listen? I'm like, that's interaction, dude.
Tell you how to be interesting.
That's the name of the game. And here's the deal. Like, you could be the best podcaster, the best fucking video essayist, the best pop culture historian, whatever the fuck title you could be given. You could be the best one in the world and make the best videos, but no one fucking watches them. And I don't know how to tell you to get people to watch them. I'm doing the same thing everyone else is doing. And we hope fucking something works. We hope the right person hears it, you know? So engagement, clicks, when those become the end-all, be-all, when that becomes what you're going after, you tailor everything to that. So integrity and ethics and fact-checking all go out the window. And what's worse is they're not just out the window, but I get the feeling that we have definitely crossed the Rubicon and are well past the fucking point of no return, to where we look at that as a society as the things I just said. In journalism, we look at it as corny.
Right. Oh, you're old school. Oh, whatever. We don't do that.
That's, yeah. So I
go selling me little punk ass dreams and shit.
Worked my way up to middle management.
Robbed him, motherfucker's blind.
So I see under your hobbies, it says drinking 40s, smoking weed, and all types of ill shit. Yes, all right. So, yeah. Anyways, Jess, there you go. Here's my live take. Not a hot one, more like a room temperature. Tepid take.
Yeah. Well, on the topic of media and trust in the media, I don't know if y'all read it, where Fauci and Psaki are being deposed for the violation of freedom of speech. Did y'all see that?
Well, go ahead and explain it.
Basically, a lawsuit was brought against Fauci, Psaki, and a couple other people. I've seen Zuckerberg's name being thrown in and out of there, but I haven't found anything official with him, where they were basically colluding with social media to tell them and silence things about COVID and silence things about Hunter Biden's laptop. So now they're going to be, there's no date, there's no time yet, but they are going to be brought under oath to answer for what has been found.
Yeah, that's where the deposition comes in. They're deposed under oath and blah, 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 yeah. blah, blah. So there's actual consequences if they can be proved to have perjured themselves.
Right. So
I mean, now here's is where my mind goes. It's pretty predictable at this point. Is this the Mandela effect, or did I have a stroke and imagine this? But didn't Zuckerberg go on the number one podcast in the fucking world, Joe Rogan, and say the FBI came to him and told him to start censoring information that he was allowing on his fucking social media platform?
Sure as shit did.
Yeah, about the Hunter Biden. They told him to keep the Hunter Biden thing quiet because it could fuck with the election.
Okay, so he's put himself between a rock and a hard place, because if he goes in that deposition and he doesn't say that exact story and he starts fucking playing wordplay with these motherfuckers,
mm-hmm.
they will eat his fucking corny white boy ass for lunch, because they are lawyers and they live for that shit. He's a fucking idiot tech guy who got lucky. He ain't a fucking mastermind when it comes to playing chess with these type of guys. These guys live for this shit.
However, he may have better lawyers than the government.
No, that's his best hope.
Yeah.
But if he goes in there and he gives the same fucking story, and he does it with that Zuckerberg, like, borderline autistic confidence that he has, that's going to be a problem. Because that means he's willing to walk into a federal courtroom or wherever this ends up ultimately, the highest court it ends up at, and back up his statement.
I'm going to guess Mark has the resources to hire a lawyer who's going to be like, so he's going to walk in with that podcast like, all right, so remember we said this on a podcast. Now let's craft everything around not perjuring you.
Well, but that'll definitely be behind very closed doors. Oh, yeah. And with cell phones turned off.
That's what you pay a lawyer for.
Yes, exactly. No, I'm with you. But yeah, I once again, I'm just like, he's kind of put himself in a, he has to basically be all in. He has to push every fucking thing he's got into the center of the table and go all in on the hand. He can't back up. I mean, I guess if he really wants, he could try to plead some sort of like Fifth Amendment shit and let his lawyer try to lawyer it up and maybe a publicist get in there and do some fucking damage control.
Well, because the thing with that, with the Hunter Biden thing is that's going to be an onion like a motherfucker, because I'm sure it's going to come out that they went to Twitter too. Because I mean, if you remember, the New York Post got thrown off of Twitter for like 6 hours.
Mm-hmm. Let me just say this, and I want to say this for you two and our half a dozen listeners, because I won't have to tell you guys, I told you so. If he gets dragged in a deposition and he actually testifies about the Hunter Biden laptop, and all of a sudden the federal government starts making this about him, Facebook, and the information he did or did not allow about that story on his fucking platforms, that, to me, that screams they're fucking trying to, don't pay attention to this hand, pay attention to this hand. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, they're making the issue him and if he's willing to testify under the fucking threat of, like, I think it's 3 years for perjury, and it even goes up more on the federal level. If he's willing to testify and the federal government doesn't fucking, you know what I'm saying? Like, look into that and fucking make a put on a show trial of going after whatever rogue element, you know what I'm saying, was walking around telling private fucking institutions, oh, you might not want, you know, something's going on, dude. What else are we supposed to infer from that situation? I mean, honestly, if he's willing to testify to that, federal agents came in and told me, don't post that. And then they go, now we go after Mark Zuckerberg. Why? That's your lead. That's the beginning of the episode of Law and Order. You don't got him.
Yeah.
That's how you find the real criminals.
Mm-hmm.
He's the one who turns you onto the trail.
Yeah.
But watch, they will fucking stop with him and they'll make it about him and Facebook. Watch. Mark my fucking words. And when I'm right and I do my victory lap, nobody say shit. Just saying that right now.
Can we congratulate you?
I mean, I guess. I don't know.
Okay. Cool. Just laying out the ground rules
he'll,
now.
He'll accept accolades.
Okay. Cool.
No one listens to me, so I guess if I start rubbing it in, even because everyone's like, hey, you fucker, told you so. Really? Really? Because we did a podcast for fucking half a decade with someone whose nickname was ICE, which was an acronym for I call everything. Because whenever fucking anything happens, I called it, y'all. No, you didn't. You literally said the opposite of that. Still. What? No! There's no still. Just saying. No, there's no just saying. None of that makes sense. These are just words and phrases you saw online.
He tried to waltz back in the chat like he hadn't been gone for 3 months.
He could have been on tonight.
Right.
I extended the invite. I put the time down. I said, you guys.
Right.
But anyways, just saying. We got your virtual seat sitting here. But anyways, podcasting, sending out the smoke signals for one.
Right.
Well, okay. I think personally that it's time for us to have a conversation about the high school volleyball.
Yeah. Let's go.
Okay. Before you guys get into whatever you get into.
Okay.
Set it up.
I want to make sure I understand all the fucking moving parts of this.
Okay.
It was a girls volleyball game with a trans girl, high school age girls, with a trans girl. So biologically born a male, transition to female, pitching.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And this trans female.
Wasn't it volleyball?
Was it volleyball or did I say volleyball or softball?
It's volleyball.
You said pitching.
Oh,
well, like,
because I got it mixed in my head. She's probably serving.
Yes.
Or she was spiking.
Yeah.
Spiking is what happened.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Sorry, I got my sports mixed up. And take it away from there. Because I want to make sure that was that none of that's in dispute, by the way, right? Like the ideological sides that have formed, neither are disputing those facts.
Correct.
No.
Okay.
No, there's a video of it too. Like, okay. you can see this happen. And then whenever she spiked the ball,
this girl got fucked up.
Yeah, she hit a girl in the face and gave her a severe concussion. Last I heard, she had to go to a rehab place? I don't know if that was a valid source or not, but I heard that she had to go to she had been discharged, but she was not cleared to play. She can't play volleyball. Unknown if she'll be able to play volleyball again. Had a head injury, but being the concussion and a neck injury, all because she was on a girls' team and playing against a biological man.
Yep. Good.
And
More of this needs to happen.
No, more.
Because it'll stop. It'll stop this. It'll stop it. It will stop this nonsense, Rich. I'm not trying to drag you in here, Rich, but we've been saying it for years on Sporgy. Someone needs to get folded in half on national television to go, oh wow, men are bigger than women.
Okay. I got a lot to say, but obviously you two got more to say. Believe me, I will say my piece. I'm going to let you two handle this. Go ahead, you guys.
These are kids. These are children, not adults. And they don't have an option. There is no other team that they can join. This is their high school team. They go where their parents say they go. They go where their parents can afford to put them. They go where they're zoned for. You don't sacrifice children to make a fucking point. Like, do it to the adult.
It's everywhere. It's all over. It's happening. It's in high school sports across the country because wokeness.
That is making everyone bend to a certain way of life to appease a sub 1%.
Trust me.
And it is, we're.
I'm with you on this. I'm with you on this. And but for as far as incidents like this, I'm saying if more of this shit happens, it will knock this shit off. There was a volleyball team, I think we talked about it, or maybe it's a podcast I listened to. There was a volleyball team in Vermont where the whole team had to go use a different locker room because the way the state law was written is they were all uncomfortable because there was a transgender person on their team, but because they were uncomfortable, they were the ones that had to go find somewhere else to change.
Four of them got kicked off the team and one of them got expelled.
Yeah. Like an entire team.
That's insanity.
Yep.
But it's not stopping it.
So, but you know what, Jess? These people these people speak the language of extreme. So you know what's extreme? Fucking concussions, fucking spinal injuries. If this shit fucking happens, to fucking get this point through people's skull that you can't. To paraphrase Richard, that you can't stick feathers in your ass and call yourself a chicken, then so fucking be it.
Okay, so should we just, like, then if the left wanted to go ahead and make a point about gun violence, should we just go hand a bunch of criminals a bunch of guns and say, tough shit, see what fucking happens? Well, I mean, that'd be a way for them to make their point, right?
It's the language of extremism, isn't it?
It's garbage to sacrifice innocent people. And say, well, that's what it's going to take. It could just be some people growing some fucking balls and putting an end to it. That sounded threatening. That's not how I meant it. I meant throwing a fit. Shit. But, like, go pitch a fit. Boycott it. Pull your kids out of those schools. The parents should be doing the work on this.
Remember Leah Thomas last year? That transgender woman who was just dominating woman swimming, and all the women who came out against he, him, her, it, whatever, they were fucking demonized, right? And they were like, because they were coming out going, this is bullshit. Like, this person should not be allowed to compete against us. But nope, wokeness.
Even still, then more people should have gotten loud. Then at that point, more people should be getting loud to raise up the voice of the people saying, no, this is bullshit.
Well, the problem is when the people who control the narrative are the ones on the opposition, they can be as loud as they want. They're never going to be heard.
Well, then why is sacrificing this girl going to make it heard?
Because wokeness. Oh, no, because if people actually start getting injured, if real-world consequences start happening, it might get the point across. And injuries are real-world consequences.
Okay, but even you just said it might get the point across. So we might have just sacrificed this girl's career, college scholarship, her, and whatever other health issue she may have down the line for nothing?
Yep, because because my ideology won.
That's bullshit.
That's not disagreeing with you. That's how it is right now. Like, that, it doesn't matter. There's a boy on the girls volleyball team. We win.
But it shouldn't be stood for. That girl should go sue the fuck out of that school.
Does she have that option? Do we know?
I don't know why she wouldn't.
I mean, it would have to be her family on her behalf, I'm assuming, because she's a minor.
Yeah, they're probably a little too busy right now trying to figure out, you know, how to make her better.
Yeah, and as far as the rehab thing, my guess is,
I hear a lawsuit against two school systems.
She probably went to the hospital. They did whatever they had to do. They checked her out. They put her through percussion protocol, but now she doesn't need to be in the hospital. And for insurance reasons, they usually put them into a quote unquote rehab facility that's like, you know, temporary, short couple days to like maybe. I guess, couple months. But
like,
you know,
I said,
yeah, that's, I'm sure that's where she's at. So
I don't know that that one was verified. I know I read that somewhere, but I did not go check a source on that. So I just want to make that really clear.
Well, my point is that I've only seen what happens with concussions when you go into a doctor with no insurance in the 90s. And it really seemed like it depended on how bad of a case of post-concussion syndrome you had at the time. Like, that they would, because it's like, if you don't have insurance, they're not going to put you in the hospital. You know what I'm saying? Like, so what I'm saying is she has a documented case of medical bills, pain and suffering. And I mean, this is, to me, I guess, where a jury would have to make the decision. By the way, just because I'm talking about this doesn't mean I agree with this. I'm just pointing this out. Strictly from a legal standpoint, I guess they would have to decide if the school district was negligent in allowing the transgender student to play, knowing this could have been an outcome.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the trial would be about. Now, having said that, Jesse brought up, when you brought up the gun point, you're like, so we just give criminals guns? And then just let it, you know, be like, well, that's how, you know, we'll figure it out.
Right.
Once again, for anyone listening, prefacing pretty much everything I'm saying, I will let you know if I'm changing it up. But go from this point on this subject, I'm talking about the extremists about this subject. That's how the left already look at guns. The extremists on the left are like, give them all guns. Let them start killing each other. Maybe if their kids die enough, then they'll fucking want them banned. And now the right looks at trans and trans kids playing sports, and they and this, it's the same way. So, I mean, what do you do? How do you get through to that? Those are people who are just like, I'm willing to make this sacrifice to win my fucking point. And it's amazing because these people, none of them are willing to sacrifice their children. It's everybody else's children they're willing to sacrifice to make their points. But that's, you know, neither here nor there, I guess.
Yeah. Well, okay. But on another side of that, too, I don't think that trans girl who did this, I don't think that there was any intention of her causing physical harm to anyone else. And imagine what that's put on her now.
Hey, you married teenage boy? That's still teenage boy in there. It's probably like, yeah, that's right, after she spiked it. I'm only half facetious. I was a teenage boy. Like, there's, especially in a competitive situation like that.
Yeah. I mean, I've been playing sports and hockey and fight breakout, and we're friends, but when we're playing and the fight breaks out, like, I've knocked dudes like cold off their feet that I'm friends with and then stood over them and talked shit.
We're back to getting socks.
Yeah, like, you know, and then 5 seconds after doing it was like, I felt so bad. I was like, oh, I really hurt him. I wasn't trying to either. And it's happened to me. I've had the shit knocked out of me and been like, had my bell rung. And my friend that like, that's right, bitch. Oh, dude, I'm sorry, bro. I'm sorry.
For all we know, that bitch was like, take her scrunchie.
Well, that just more.
I want her headband.
Get her Crocs.
Yeah, give me that headband.
That so much more highlights just the difference between girls and boys. Girls don't do that. If we hurt someone, we feel bad.
But that's what I'm saying. No, like,
most guys, it's either you gloat or you laugh, and then your conditioning and kicks in over your instincts, and you feel bad.
Yes. And what I'm getting, at is you can change the wrapping paper all you want. That's a teenage boy in there mentally.
Okay, now, so that was, okay, that's my point about the gun comparison. So you got to understand, you're already dealing with people who are willing to stack bodies to make a point, to win an ideological argument. So, I mean, how much do you really want to get into the fucking tall grass with these morons? Me, I'm not willing to go very far. Now, here's my question to both of you guys. I'll ask you first, Chris. When you hear a story like this, outside of what you think needs to happen or should happen or poetic justice or whatever, like, honestly, all jokes aside, what are your goals you would hope, like, for these kids? Meaning, like, what would be the ideal situation for these kids who want to play sports and some of them are trans and some of them aren't?
Well, they have boys teams. They have girls teams. Are we looking at a third team?
And why would you want to go that route, though? I mean, like, what is the goal? I'm trying not to put words in your mouth. What is the goal of dividing people up along those lines? Ultimately, why are you doing that?
Well, actually, no, because you know, if it was, it would still be an end up mismatch because that trans goes both ways, right? You'd still have men playing against women in a sense. I don't know. Maybe you got to play. Maybe you just got to go with your original parts. Sorry, you're on the boys' team.
Okay.
Sorry, you're on the girls' team.
All right. So, Jess, what is your ultimate goal? Like, what is your concern, and what do you want to make sure does or does not happen with these kids?
I do not want to see them playing in a situation that they can be hurt. When you're an adult, if you can be, if it's an adult team, and you get to make that choice, and I'm actually taking college out of that. I'm talking anything more. I don't know. Are there pro volleyball teams? I assume there would be.
I know. Right? I mean, I think Olympic is pretty much like pinnacle. I knew a guy who was an alternate for like the Olympic volleyball team, and that was like, I was like, what would you have done if you'd have won one gold medal? He's like, retire. There's nothing else to do. Like, you're not going to be the Michael Jordan of volleyball. If you're hot and you're a chick, beach volleyball.
Right.
No, honestly, what I would truly say would be the most quote unquote fair is if you're making that choice, if you are making this lifestyle choice and you are willing to change literally everything about you, your name, the way you dress, what anatomy that you have and what hormones you're pumping through your body, you're not going to be able to play on gender specific sports. Go find a co-ed team that'll take you.
Okay.
They don't have they don't have featherweights fight heavyweights.
Right.
Well, in UFC type fights, they do, don't they? It used to be back in the day, they would have like people who had completely different fighting disciplines fight each other.
When UFC was starting, it was like
straight
yeah.
cage fighting. Like, we're going to have this guy who's a karate guy fight this guy who's a Roman Greco wrestler.
Yeah.
Versus this guy who's a professional boxer.
Yeah.
And we'll throw a bear in because it's UFC.
Yeah, it was just people who can fight.
All right, well, look, here's the deal. This is what I was not trying to guide you guys to, which is, it seems like, Jess, you stated it pretty clearly, Chris, in a roundabout way, you don't want the kids to fuck themselves up so adults can, you know what I'm saying? Like, safety of the kids. I don't think these people, these extremists, these ideological extremists, that's not their goal. Their goal is not for a safe experience. Their goal is to abolish gender. And I'm not exaggerating. Go on Google. Turn off safe search. Explain to your significant other if they're the type who are going to snoop and get suspicious, because this is, you might have a hard time explaining this one. Search. I swear to God, this is a real thing. I've done it. I got sucked into rabbit holes for hours at a time online. Gender abolitionist. It's a thing. It's a big thing in the LGBT community. And it's something that no one speaks about. These people, that's their goal, is to abolish gender. And these are the people who are the extremists, who are the loudest, driving the conversation from their side. So what is going to be, what's one of the laws of physics? For every action, there is a
reaction.
Equal and opposite reaction.
Yeah.
So if that's the type of extremist one side's putting forward, why the fuck do you think you're not going to get the fucking photo negative side, flip side of the same coin, extremist coming from the other side of the ideological spectrum?
Ooh. Post-genderism, it is focused on the idea of eliminating or moving beyond gendered identities. In a traditional gender construct, one is either a man or a woman, but in post-genderism, one is neither a man nor woman nor any other assumed gender role.
By the way, gender abolitionist is the old term, but by old, I mean probably in the last couple of years it's fallen out of favor because of the fucking association. It's purely just because it's the same word of abolitionist and in the slave fucking trade and everything in America. So yes, what was it? Gender,
post-gender.
Post-gender. That's
post-genderism.
The new term. Yes. These are the people you're dealing with. These people. Okay, so let me explain this. On one side, you have parents of these kids who are trying to raise kids in a world that's completely fucked up and chaotic. All right, and they just want what's best for their kids. And then you get these fucking ideologues who latch onto these issues because they can fucking flaunt it and own the libs or own the cons and win their ideological arguments online. None of these people No, stop listening to them. It doesn't matter what the fuck. They are insane. What gender is a problem that needs to be eradicated out of everything going on in this world right now with 7 billion people.
Don't listen to them, buddy. You're not going anywhere.
I mean, I'm sorry. It's just like when, you know, the millennials decided the least masculine generation in the history of the world decided masculinity is the biggest problem this world faces. I don't know. I don't know what, like, this is.
Masculinity built bridges, paved the roads.
Here's the deal. Chris, I totally understand where you're coming from, and I have said it, and I do mean it. I do think I did say the caveat of college, and basically you got to be 18. And if you're 18 and you're dumb enough to go on a fucking field with a fucking Division I football team, college football team, I'm smart enough to sit there and watch you get fucked up for my entertainment. Thank you very much. But when it comes to kids, here's where I got to be the asshole, Jess. Where the fuck are the parents on this? Why are you allowed to participate? That's your only recourse. That's your only recourse at this point.
Your kid don't have to play volleyball.
It sucks. It's not fair. Absolutely. But this is the option. This is the... It's not the guaranteed outcome, and it's probably one of the worst outcomes that could have happened. But it is a possibility, and it's not that remote of an experience. Because this isn't the first time I've heard of one of these stories. Apparently, the only reason I heard about this story as much as I have is it has a video to accompany it that I haven't seen yet. So that's kind of ironic, because I read the fucking story. You guys have watched the video.
She's fucked up. Hold on, let me find it.
It's okay. We're in an audio format, and we can let's just say by the time you're hearing this, I will have watched the video. So yes,
I agree with you about the parents. I really do. Like, I really think parents need to be throwing more of a fit over things like this. But the thing of taking the other girls off the team, like I said, what if that's their chance at scholarships? Sorry, you picked the wrong thing to get good at.
This is why I've said this for all my life. You have to have people who don't serve an ideological master. People who are just there to make sure the scales don't tip in anyone's favor. Because this is the same shit that we're talking about was coming from the ideological right when we were kids. All the arguments that are being made now for the trans, quote unquote, trans right LGBT community people were coming from the fundamentalist Christians when we were kids. Chris, am I lying? Am I exaggerating?
Nope.
And I'm not saying that in a hateful way. If you're listening and you're a Christian and you're young and you don't remember that, look, man, good for you. You missed a really shitty time in your religion. It's not your fault. I don't hold you personally responsible. But I'm not going to fucking act like it didn't happen, especially because I see the same patterns playing themselves out coming from the other side. And instead of preaching more extremism to fight extremism, why don't we preach temperance in this situation? Why don't we go to parents? You don't want your kid playing with trans students who could physically fuck your child up for life? I know it's not fair. I know it sucks, but you can't sign that permission slip. You can't fucking.
See, that's another thing I wonder. If they sign like some type of permission slip to play in this game, no lawsuits for nobody. They went, oh, we'll play with this person and you got hurt. Oh, well.
Unless it was left off, and I feel like it probably would be left off, they're not going to send out a permission slip saying, and by the way, they're going to be playing against a biological male.
Oh, my God. I'm just saying this right now. I could see this getting so fucking convoluted and up its own ass legally, because I got to think, what is the state's law on trans high school athletes? Mm-hmm. Does that supersede any contract that's been signed? Is that contract up to date with all the state laws that have been changed in the last
what
fucking
state
half
was
decade?
This in?
Let's see.
I'm sorry, listeners. I'm going to start drinking again until I have two brain cells left so I can fucking dumb it down. Cause I get really lost in minutia of shit sometimes. Cause I'm just thinking all the legal implications of this situation.
No, that's a good, but you brought up a good point.
I'm sorry. There will be more dick and fart jokes coming.
Yes.
North Carolina. And just real quick. The trans student who did this, just to prove one of y'all's points, I just went to a website. The headline is Trans High School Volleyball Player uses vicious spike, which seriously injured female opponent in their highlight reel.
Yeah, there's a boy in there. There is now, a teenage boy in there.
Okay, this is definitely going off script, but now do you see what it's like to be a guy? It's not just the fact that, because here's the thing, not every guy is like what we talked about, has that instinct. And there are professional athletes who are some of the greatest in the world who don't have that killer instinct. LeBron James, I think Chris and I at least have theorized over the years, does not have that killer instinct.
Nope.
Michael Jordan did. Shaq did. Kobe did. LeBron, he doesn't. But even if you're a guy and you don't have that instinct, you have to deal with other guys who do. So it's yes. still your problem. So this is why when I hear women go, you don't understand what it's like to be a woman. And everywhere I go, I'm afraid of violence. Bitch, what the fuck you think it's like to be a man?
And I'll tell you this. And all these sensitive male blah, 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 blah. Stop it. No. Every guy's got that one thing they're like that about. Even the most man bun having, fucking coffee drinking, you know, yoga pants wearing. Every guy's got that one thing. They'd beat another dude at it. They're like, yo, it's right in your face.
You might have done a podcast with one. I found his thing watching, coming into the room, and he didn't realize I was, and he was playing Mario Kart.
Yeah.
Ooh, the shit that was coming out of his mouth shocked me.
Oh, yeah, have you ever, just gamers, competitive gamers? Oh, man. You ever played Man Against Anybody online? I mean, shit.
No, because I got tired of being called a bunch of racial slurs.
Right? Yeah.
By 10-year-olds who were whooping my ass, too. That's like, the sad part.
They're just, there is something that comes with the Y chromosome and the set of testicles and testosterone. It is what makes us us.
I think when you're younger, it's almost a fucking urge to impose your will upon somebody else, because your entire life, everybody else's will has been imposed upon you at that point. Especially now in modern times, if you're the father of boys, and you've been preaching, and when you were growing up, you were preaching all this fucking feminist bullshit. Either get ready to raise two half fucking bundles of sticks, or
the butchiest girl in the county.
Well, no. Or you're going to be like one of these fucking like men's rights advocates by the time your kid starts dating, because you're going to see the world from the other side that you've never seen. I'm just saying, some of the most ardent men's rights supporters were the fucking loudest, most cunty fucking twats of feminists that I wished fucking cervical cancer upon every day of the fucking, I had the displeasure of knowing these bitches. And then their kids dated the wrong bitch, got caught with the wrong bitch, got fucked over in a divorce or a custody battle.
Yeah.
And it turns into fuck these cunts, fuck these bitches. Men don't get a fair shake. And I'm like, where the fuck was this for the rest of you? Where was this, huh? Huh?
So yeah. Even on Scrubs, I mean, JD, when the doctors were being raided, is the one thing that he was like, yeah, in your face. Mr. Happy Sensitive, I love everyone. That's it. Men have that in them. They all got the one thing. Like, it's just, you beat somebody at it, you're like, damn right. Yeah. You're married to a man. You have two men. You have two tiny men. You should have a front row seat to this.
But they're not playing against women, and they know how to treat women.
See, but that's the thing.
In like, front of you.
Here's the thing. Well, I mean, like...
Listen, no, I see how they treat each other. Listen, totally different story, and I'm not even...
All right, am I playing a video game against a woman? Because I'll say whatever the fuck I want to say.
Level playing field. There's no physical involved, yeah.
Here's the deal. I pretty much... This is how I gauge what I'm willing to say and what I'm not. Am I willing to fight this motherfucker?
Right.
If the answer is yes... you're getting me rough, rugged, and raw, two barrels straight to the chest, unfiltered, baby. I'm not going to fucking censor myself. But I'd be the ugliest trans bitch in the world. But if I was trans and I, for some reason, found myself playing against biological women, this is just my nature. I don't know, especially, well, now, 45-year-old me, I couldn't go 100%. If I was in my peak fucking, like, the best shape I was ever in, I'd fuck a bitch up, dude. Like, quick, fast, and in a hurry. I'm no doubt. But now, as a teenager in the heat of the moment, especially if I'm fucking like taking my foot off the gas or I'm like pumping the brake and like, you know, they get a couple fucking like good shots in or a couple points or baskets or whatever and start talking shit. Yeah. And that guy fucking Gene, that instinct kicks in and you got to, hey, bitch, shut the fuck up because daddy just came home.
You said a little pick a little too rough.
Yeah. The only thing I want to hear out your mouth is harder, daddy. That's it. Shut your fucking hole.
I see. You brought it out in Rich. He's even a hypothetical situation.
Well, no. Okay. One of our co-hosts on Regimented, Todd, right? Todd and I both are pretty avid baseball fans. And so we played a baseball video game, but we'd never played each other. So he's like, okay, we finally got the game. We can be online. We can play. But we got to bet something. What do you want to bet? And I was like, I don't know. Whoever loses got to call the other guy daddy or something. He's like, I'm not calling a grown man daddy. And I was like, all right, we'll tip our hats. Take a picture of tipping the hat, you know? Like, hey, you got me, dude. Good one, right? You know, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So sure as shit, we play. And long story short, he throws me three fucking curveballs in the exact same spot. And in the game, it was set up to where you could guess the pitch and the location. And I picked up his patterns as a pitcher, and I knew his patterns. And I was like, he's going to fucking go
start
through the
smoking them.
So I just sat fucking curveball down and in for three straight pitches and waited for one that was in the zone and put it in the fucking seats. And he came unglued. Like, I stopped playing video games with Todd for a little bit over that. Like this is like that's how competitive he was over that. And I'm like, bro, it's just a video.
Todd has left the match.
It's just a video. Yeah. Competitive, petty, to the point where, like, a couple months later, we played each other again, and I used the same team. And he had remembered the player I was using when I fucking hit the walk-off homer, and every time he came to the plate, he'd drill the guy in the head in the game, and he goes, fuck it, he ain't hitting another home run off me. I'm like, bro, you need to talk to somebody. Let it go. I mean, seriously.
There you go, Jess. Dudes. These are two middle-aged dudes.
Allegedly. I mean, emotional right. development.
Right.
Early 20s.
Birth certificate says middle age. Yeah.
We're about 20 years behind. I will just speak for myself. I'm probably about around 25 age range emotionally. Yeah.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
By now, you've probably seen ads about water contamination at Camp Lejeune everywhere on TV, social media, and probably even following you around on the internet. The water at Marine Corps Base Camp Lejeune was contaminated with toxic chemicals for more than 3 decades. It is not rare for people who drank this water for an extended period of time to develop severe illness, including kidney cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, leukemia, liver cancer, bladder cancer, birth defects, Parkinson's, and more. A new law called the PACT Act allows victims of poisoned water to seek repayment for their medical costs. What those other ads don't tell you is that because the PACT Act is a fresh law, it is important to find an attorney who understands the new claims forms. There is limited time to file your Camp Lejeune claim, so you need a lawyer who can get it right the first time. The experienced team of attorneys at sickmarine.com is ready to file your claim. They will fight for you and won't take no for an answer. To file your claim and to have your case prioritized, sign up at sickmarine.com.
Has winning lost its luster? If you or someone you know suffers from a gambling disorder, help is available at 800gambler.org. Today is the day to help yourself or a loved one get their life back. Not getting help means losing time with family, friends, life events, and sometimes even more. Go to 800gambler.org or call 1-800-GAMBLER. Treatment is confidential and works. Have a gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. We answer 24/7, 365.
Take advantage of Johnson & Johnson's winter wellness event and get rewarded. It pays to be prepared for the season. Get sweet deals from Johnson & Johnson's Winter Wellness event now through December 3rd. If you purchase $15 or $25 of participating products at BJ's, you can get a $5 or $10 reward. Plus, you can even enter to win a Visa Rewards card. Purchase at BJ's, upload your receipt, and choose your reward. It pays to be prepared at BJ's.
By now, you've probably seen ads about water contamination at Camp Lejeune everywhere on TV, social media, and probably even following you around on the internet. The water at Marine Corps Base Camp Lejeune was contaminated with toxic chemicals for more than 3 decades. It is not rare for people who drank this water for an extended period of time to develop severe illness, including kidney cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, leukemia, liver cancer, bladder cancer, birth defects, Parkinson's, and more. A new law called the PACT Act allows victims of poisoned water to seek repayment for their medical costs. What those other ads don't tell you is that because the PACT Act is a fresh law, it is important to find an attorney who understands the new claims forms. There is limited time to file your Camp Lejeune claim, so you need a lawyer who can get it right the first time. The experienced team of attorneys at sickmarine.com is ready to file your claim. They will fight for you and won't take no for an answer. To file your claim and to have your case prioritized, sign up at sickmarine.com.
Take advantage of Johnson & Johnson's winter wellness event and get rewarded. It pays to be prepared for the season. Get sweet deals from Johnson & Johnson's winter wellness event now through December 3rd. If you purchase $15 or $25 of participating products at BJ's, you can get a $5 or $10 reward. Plus, you can even enter to win a Visa rewards card. Purchase at BJ's, upload your receipt, and choose your reward. It pays to be prepared at BJ's.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.
But okay, so let's kind of do a quick lightning round here on the and then we'll go ahead and call it a week here. Give us some subjects that we can fucking goof on and have fun with real quick, Jess.
We don't talk about anything happy.
Well, I just want to point out that the new Scooby-Doo, one of the new Scooby-Doo shows, they made Daphne Asian. And it happens to be the Scooby-Doo show. There's no Scooby-Doo the dog. What are they trying to imply? How else am I supposed to? That's dog whistle. It's dog whistle racism, right?
Are you comfortable with using the term dog whistle in this situation? You okay with that word choice?
I mean, I didn't say like poodle poo-poo platter.
That bitch ain't Scooby-Doo. That's what you're saying.
And by the way, what? That's racist. If you go over to certain countries in Asia, they eat fucking our pets.
Yeah.
You go over to other countries, they look at us eating cows and they're like, that's a sacred. That's
yeah,
a
India India that's loves sacred. Cows. Yeah.
Like you, they will start chopping body parts off you harm a cow in certain parts of the world.
I mean, like, you ever eat steak? That cow is delicious.
It's a sacred cow, and you know what?
Sacredly delicious.
Yeah, exactly. Especially medium rare. Hell yeah! Yeah. Blood don't stop nothing but a or period don't stop nothing but a sentence, baby. I ain't afraid of blood.
Okay. Anyway, the no phones at work thing, that was a little fun. That was a fun read.
Okay. Disregarding where it
I did
came
not
from.
Read the comments section.
Okay, good. Because
I did not even.
It popped up on my like recommended. On my Reddit, and I saw the picture, and then I scrolled down, and I didn't look that it came from the anti-work subreddit. I was just I just saw it, and I thought it was in a Reddit related to a line of work I'm in. And I started scrolling down, and I'm like, man, how do these motherfuckers make money? Everyone doesn't want to work. And then I scrolled back up and was like, oh, that's why.
Yeah,
it's anti-work. It's literally like, we all want universal basic income. The government needs to give us money. How the fuck do you think the government's getting money if nobody's working, stupid?
Yeah.
But, yes, would you read the note, Jess?
Yes. One moment.
Or do you have it pulled up, Chris?
I can have it pulled up super fast. I'm already scrolling up. It says, due to recent lapses in judgment regarding cell phone use at work, the following policy is now in place from this point forward. All cell phones must be kept turned off at work at all times. This means completely turned off so that the phone won't ring, vibrate, or make any other noise or function in any way. This doesn't just mean turn the screen off. This means the entire phone must be completely powered off. Only blanked out are permitted to use their cell phones while at work. Your cell phone must be completely out of sight. Ladies, keep them in your purse or bags or desks or counter. Men, keep them in your pocket or desk or desk on the counter. I should not see a cell phone at all. You are not permitted to charge your cell phone at work. There is no need to charge it if you aren't going to use it. Charge it at home. If someone is observed by myself or blanked out, during work hours using their cell phone in any way, charging their cell phone, or if a cell phone is in sight, the employee's wages will be reduced by $2 per hour for 1 month for the first occurrence. If there is a second occurrence, the employee will be fired for violating the cell phone policy. This is not a joke, and I would suggest you do not test the new policy's validity, as there is zero tolerance towards cell phone use at work. You are paid to work, not use your cell phone. If you think you can't find something to do, start cleaning the entire store. Then when you're done with that, start over cleaning the entire store. If someone needs to get in touch with you at work, then give them the telephone number, and it blanks that out.
All right, so when I saw that, I was like, first of all, I think my mind went the same place Chris's mind went to. What the fuck happened to make all that necessary?
Yeah, this isn't like, you know, like
that isn't a no cell phones at work with a circle and a line draw thrown it laminated thrown on a wall.
Like, remember when they dragged Dr. Dow off the plane? My whole thing was like, they don't just drag you off the plane. Like, they didn't, like,
it escalated to that.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm gonna be honest with you. In my experience, that's not a boss I'd work for, but that's beside
the point. Yeah, that's my personal opinion of, I would not handle that situation like that.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
But first thing comes to mind is if it's a job where they can dock 2 hours worth of pay, that means you never signed any type of contract. So that means it's an at-will employment state, which means you can walk the fuck out and they can't do shit. I'm petty. Depending on how much of a dick he was towards everybody, I might wait till it's fucking rush and be like, hey, guess what? I'm leaving.
Mm-hmm.
And then pull my cell phone out of my pocket and be like, and I'm going to Facebook on the way out, just so you know. But those type of jobs aren't jobs that are like careers in my experience. The only type of jobs I've ever worked that I would put up with that, if he was an asshole directly to me about it, would be like the manufacturing jobs from the 90s I had. And if I was making that amount of money adjusted for inflation and all the shit over time. And that's almost 30 years ago now. So, I mean, I got to imagine, like, I don't think that's a factory job is what I'm saying.
I'm guessing
this is not an office job either. I think it's probably a retail or food service industry job.
Yeah, I'm guessing productivity was being affected by cell phones. And they went, all right, none of you get to use them. I'm willing to bet, too, it was probably like one asshole, too.
Yeah. And I mean, like, it was funny because I've worked in a pizza place, and the rule was we had a phone bank, which was basically like a stand-up chest-high bar where we answered the phones and we put the orders in. And, you know, if it was dead or we had downtime, the rule was, unless you're using your phone to play music and it's got to, you know, you have to have a wired connection or something, put your cell phones, play music, whatever you want to do with them, check them when, you know, between tasks that you have to do for your job, but keep them on there. We don't care. I even had a boss who was like, someone had one of the biggest fucking screen cell phone. Mm-hmm. It was curved. It fits in your back pocket and the curvature of your ass thing. And they, like, set it up and was watching movies while fucking doing dough on the, you know what I'm saying, from across the store. And it was like, so my guess is that was probably tried, like, some sort of compromise, which, you know, obviously didn't work. And he got to this point, him or her, the boss. And I'm just thinking, like, is this part of this whole, like, can't find anyone to work attitude? Meaning, is this what caused people going, hey, I'll just walk the fuck out? Or is this because he can't find anyone to work and this is a fucking owner or a manager who's at his wit's end or their wit's end, him, her, whatever, and is just fucking lashing out at employees because it's the only thing they could fucking think to do?
I think that, like, it's my experience a year ago was the inmates are running the asylum. And there ain't a goddamn thing you can do about it because then you're working by yourself. And fuck that.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. I mean, look,
I've worked in food service. I've worked in retail. Full disclosure, I didn't even have a cell phone or a smartphone until 2014. So if I pulled out my old dyno phone before then, I mean, what am I going to do? Play Snake? You know what I'm saying? I mean, like, that was not that big of an issue. And so I never got used to fucking, you know, finger fucking my phone at work. So when they were like, you know, got to cut down on the cell phone usage at work, folks. I was like, I cut. Oh, okay.
Cool. It's like done and done.
Hey, yeah. You got to cut down fingering yourself up your ass when you wipe. Well, I don't do that in the first place. So it's going to be real easy to go ahead and go cold turkey on. I'm just going to go ahead and say that. So It's kind of one of those things. But I can see where you try to implement reasonable compromises. The employees aren't listening. And so you go fucking basically scorched earth. You go full on fucking dictator and like, there's two ways to do this. My way and the highway. And that's it. Mm-hmm. I don't care if I'm right or wrong. It's my way or you don't work here. And that's what that note tells me, which once again, I read a little bit more into it, but it does seem like there is, and I've noticed this in my day-to-day life, a lot more open hostility between management and rank and file, especially that they're willing to show to customers where they usually put the facade of like, hi, welcome to Hardee's. How are you today? You know what I'm saying? Like, no, just like open hostility amongst the ranks.
Oh, yeah.
And no one's given a fuck. No one cares. No one is even ashamed or thinks that this is corny or a bad look or unprofessional. In fact, they think they're justified.
Because guess what? The manager don't want to work by themselves either. Like the manager's just one of them that's got elevated. And here, you get a couple more bucks an hour. And now everything's your fault.
See, I loved working for managers like that because at least I could go to them and be like, look here, man, I get it. Motherfucker, here's the deal. You were in a position to where you could take the short-term fucking cut and pay to go management. I went into pizza places. After a certain point, you either go driver or management, in my experience. If you can take the pay hit, the temporary pay hit, the long-term benefits of going management tend to outweigh them if you do it right. But I would tell them, you went management, I went driver. But ultimately, we're just them with a little bit more fucking responsibility. You have to remember that. The minute you start looking at us, them, We're not working anymore. This is now a fucking hostile environment that we're not going to get shit done because we can't even, we're walking around petty fucking shooting daggers at each other behind each other's backs when we're trying to work together at a goal, which is get the fuck out of here.
I can tell you the problem is, or one of the problems is, I should say the problem, is somebody who made that ascent. The problem is us versus them doesn't come from you. Because once you've been elevated and us now views you as them. Do you get what I'm saying?
No, yeah.
Like the rank and file now, you're now not one of them anymore.
Well, you can see it in how the auto industry in Detroit played out. If you were a line worker, or, you know, if you were in the union, you were considered a floor guy, shop guy, line worker, whatever your title was. But when you went into management, you had to leave the union. And there was a clear line of separation between union and non-union workers. And when union workers would cross the line into management, they became persona non grata. I mean, it was like some fucking brother versus brother, north and south shit. Bad 80s, you know, miniseries on television. Like, I've even friends to this day, I've heard like, yeah, I had a friend who I came in, got hired in with, blah, blah, blah. We worked right next to each other, went to each other's weddings, were there when each other's kids were born. He's in management, and now we don't talk. And I'm just like, if that's the end goal, that's not good for anybody.
Yeah. Like, as he advanced his career, now you're not friends?
But, I mean, if you know about the auto industry, they're probably making comparable money. Just one's probably being compensated more via benefits than the other.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and it's just...
Probably the union guy. At least with the UAW.
Yeah, well, for the benefits? Yeah, especially if he's an older union guy. But, so, I mean, like, there's... I mean, when you read the note, just... If I walked into a job and just saw that note, like, and it was my second day, I don't know if I would have a third day. I'm not saying I'd leave during my first break. I mean, I've done that once, but I mean, like once, but it was well deserved. That's a story for another day.
My reaction would be like, who fucked up? Why can't I use my cell phone now?
Yes. There was a moment and when I was in rehab and we're supposed to turn the lighters in, right? Because you're not allowed to have lighters. So we go out for our smoke break, and they do the, you know, okay, we handed out four lighters, we want four back. And they handed out four lighters. and three came back. And the workers were cool. They were like, all right, finish your cigarettes. And they got us in. They were like, all right, here's the deal. No more smoking until we get that lighter back. And I basically stood up and was like, here's the deal. I'm in here. I got to be sober. I can't fuck. I can't call nobody. I can't have no phone. I can't have cable. I can't have sports. The only thing I can have is a motherfucking cigarette. If y'all don't produce this lighter, I'm going to tell you, I'm not locked in here with you. You're locked in here with me. Find this motherfucking lighter. And it was like, literally, one of my boys from my crew was like, can I go to my box? I said, yeah. And I went to the box and he goes, could you open my box for me? Yeah. And it's the contraband box. And he goes, it was the lighter I had when I come in. You said a lighter. There you go. Now you have four lighters. Can we go get our cigarette, please, before Rich kills everybody?
Nice. Did they let you?
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. The staff was like,
well, we said four.
He was an old military, retired military guy. And I was like, he is an asshole for fucking detail. He said a lighter. He won't respect you for going, doing this run to run, you know, end around and fucking loophole, but he will honor it. And sure as shit, he was like, oh, that's some bitch shit, but all right. I did say if I had four lighters, you can go out, go get your cigarettes.
Nice.
So yes, I would walk in and be like, who did this?
Yeah.
And on top of that, now here's the other thing. That note tells me that's someone probably in their late 20s to 30s working with a bunch of teens in early 20s, because
that's someone with no leadership experience.
Well, not only that, but if I'm a fucking 35-year-old with fucking teenage kids and I come in and see that note, I'm doing what the fuck I'm going to do with my cell phone as a parent no matter what. And if the motherfucker tries to come up and nut up on me, I'm going to be like, okay, we can punch out going and getting some gangster shit. I don't know who the fuck you think you are, Skippy.
Yeah, right.
Okay. But I got kids who are damn near your age. I'll be damned if I'm going to fucking put the phone away on silent, because if shit hits the fan, I need to know about it.
Yeah.
They're not calling to let me know about the new Billie Eilish song. Okay. Texting me to know about the new Billie Eilish song.
Come on, Luddite.
So, yeah. I mean, but that's where your mind goes as an adult. Whereas as a kid, you just think, man, this is some bullshit. This is unfair. Yeah. And really, it's like, it is bullshit. It is unfair. So why did y'all act like fucking assholes to make it get to this point?
Yeah. Like I said, my original reaction was like, well, they didn't fucking put on the hairdryer, don't use it in the tub, until somebody used it in the tub.
What was the... It's a meme, but it's true. It's a owner's manual from like 1989 for a vehicle. And it shows you how much to gap your spark plugs to do a tune-up and change your, you know, when you do a tune-up, change your spark plugs. And they showed an owner's manual from like 2 years ago, and it said, do not crack open your battery and drink the contents. And I'm like, yeah, that's about right.
Brother, you know that's there. Like, it's there because somebody did it.
Yes, I'm like, that's about right.
They didn't randomly just put that there. Oh, people shouldn't drink this shit. Nope, somebody fucking drank it. And now it has to, because of lawyers, now it's got to be on the fucking battery.
Between 1989 and 2019,
yeah,
that became required.
Yes, in 30 years, someone drank the fucking battery acid.
I feel like Edward Furlong in Terminator 2. We're not going to make it, people. I mean, you know, like just like this is just, how did we make it this far? This is like the most accident-prone kid with the most fucking like apathetic, doesn't pay attention parents ever. Who never has a mark on him. How? What deal with the devil did you make? This is impossible. This is not possible. But anyways. All right. One more.
One more.
Give us a quick one. Go out on a high note here.
Let's see. We have the meme abortion bullshit that's going around.
Yes, because we've already all pretty much said how we feel about abortion. No need to keep restating that. Please read this meme, because
it's a Twitter update status or whatever.
Yes. One moment, please.
Which, by the way, as someone who actually, yes, I know this makes me a loser. It's only one of many things, trust me. As someone who makes memes and releases them into the wild, and I don't even do my own watermark or take credit for them, I'm really upset that motherfuckers think screenshotting Twitter, cropping the screenshot, and then fucking posting it is a meme. I work hard coming up with the bullshit shit posting captions I fucking put on pictures. Do some legwork,
right?
Lazy cocksuckers. Anyways.
All right. It says, when your wife is dying from sepsis because doctors aren't allowed to treat her partial miscarriage, the last thing on your mind will be the price of milk.
What? I want to say right now, I said in the chat, I want to know what red state hospitals are not treating miscarriages. And a miscarriage is a medical procedure. It's not birth control. It's not. You don't choose to have a miscarriage. It's something that happens. It's something that you go get treated. What the fuck reality does this person live in?
That doesn't exist. It's not an abortion. A miscarriage implies that the baby has passed away. The fetus, the zygote, whatever, is no longer a living thing. You have miscarried it. So a partial miscarriage is whenever you don't expel the baby on your own. And they have to, they have to go in and take the baby out, usually through a DNC. There's no doctor that's going to be like, nope, can't go remove that. Just, I guess, push real hard, think hard thoughts, get it out.
like the last episode of House of the Dragon where the chick has the miscarriage and she has to pull the baby halfway that died coming out of her during birth halfway out. Yeah.
Did they arrest her after that for performing an abortion?
No, actually, the Gold Cloaks let her stay the night outside of the Black Dungeon for that, surprisingly. But, okay, look, man, I'm not an expert. I don't have a fucking uterus. I don't have a vagina. I don't even have a man-made vagina, okay?
Give it time.
I mean, I guess you talk to one of my exes who was mad at me, I have an oversized clit or an undersized dick. So I guess maybe that makes me kind of qualified to say what I'm about to say. I'm calling bullshit on this as far as it being a big enough issue to where we need to base entire fucking laws on the federal level around this type of case, this type of specific medical situation. I can't believe it's that common to where this is a concern that we need to factor in when we are writing the laws for this issue. That's where I draw the line, and that's where it's like you're hurting your own cause, guys. It's like I said about the thing with Jill Biden at the Eagles game. Enough people were booing, enough people were chanting, "Let's go, Brandon." Some were even chanting, "Fuck Joe Biden." You had that. You didn't need to edit in fake chants and cheers and boos and shit. It just makes you look like you're starting off from a place of fucking lying and deceit from Jump Street. Am I the only one who feels that way?
No.
It's sensational.
You're gilding the lily. Use another fucking metaphor. Why not?
I mean, because it just feels like this does it. It has the antithetical effect that you're going for. You want to gather support. You want to draw allies in. I think all of us, for whatever reason, at least on a civil libertarian level, pretty much agree. We don't want the government telling us what to do with our bodies, and we don't want them telling other people to do with their bodies.
I think all three of us said we're pro-choice, but this is a meme like this is insanity. Like, no,
this actually makes me fucking not want to support these people anymore. Because I'm like, this can't be the level of discourse because it's dishonest.
Yes.
It's a fucking lie. We can't build. Sorry. Maybe we should have cut it off early. I'm working myself up. You can't build something and take an issue with so many moving parts and so complex as this and build it on a foundation of bullshit and expect it to be anything but a house that implodes in on itself the first chance it has. And that's just what I see us heading for. And this shit does not help. And I know the people I'm right. I know the women who posted this, the people who posted it. It is more than one person. They're well-intentioned. They're not trying to be hyperbolic. They really fucking are concerned about these issues and shit, But
it's a terrible argument.
Exactly, man. Exactly.
But to the people who are getting their news off of TikTok, they're going to see this and they're going to see their little influencers saying, this is why it's so important to go vote, guys. And they're going to be like, well, I don't want to die of sepsis if I have a miscarriage. And that's the amount of legwork they're willing to do.
I that doesn't shock me. And I mean, sadly, I think that is the baseline these days. That's the standard. I think you start from there and you either go up or down. But I think most people, it's just apathy is just the standard settings. It comes from the factory. It's standard default.
Oh, man, I'm going to start another conversation and I don't want to, but it ties in with this. The governor's race here in Michigan, there is a commercial that is being played that I just found out. I've been watching it for months. It's fucking, it's taken out of context. It's totally wrong. And it's not what the fucking person is saying. Shocking in a political ad, I know. But it's an ad for Gretchen Whitmer. No, let me just find, because the audio will make the point here.
By the way, Tudor Dixon?
Call me.
Well, no, I'm just saying, like, I must have seen her plenty of times, because I'm like, oh, that, I feel like I'm in that Snoop Dogg song. Oh, that Sadie. Yeah, used to be my homegirl's lady. Oh, that bitch.
Yeah.
When 80 I saw degrees her, like,
when I tell the that bitch please.
Raise up off your and you tease because you get none of these at ease. But anyways, yeah, I was like, oh, I've seen this bitch before. And then I was like, oh, okay. I mean, I still won't vote for you because you're a politician. And you're a politician who's probably only running because the GOP in this state thinks they have to run someone who's marginally more attractive than Whitmer, who honestly wasn't a bad looking woman when she was younger. But, you know, apparently getting all those vaccination shots have made her age a lot in the last couple of years. I don't know.
My God, how can I? This ad is on every fucking break. Why can't I find it right now? I'm searching videos. Let me see if it just comes up.
Well,
because I need the audio.
Well, since we're talking the Michigan gubernatorial race here, is there any national traction for the Michigan governor race up here?
Not that I've seen.
Okay. I was just wondering because, you know, obviously, I mean, we've talked about it a little bit before, but, you know, Whitmer definitely raised her fucking national profile during COVID.
Oh, yeah.
By aligning herself with
that woman from Michigan
and all that. So, yeah, I didn't know.
I think she also ran his campaign, too.
Yeah, like, she had a position in his campaign.
I found the end. Here we go.
If you take Tudor Dixon at her word when it comes to outlawing abortion, she's told us exactly who she is.
Are you for the exemptions for rape and incest?
I am not.
You said
right here.
No exceptions. But the question would be like a 14-year-old who, let's say, is a victim of abuse by an uncle.
Yeah.
You're saying carry that?
No exceptions.
Okay. Where she says, perfect example right there. That clip finishes with what she's saying perfect example of is they're talking about Proposal 3. And apparently under Proposal 3, she's saying it would become harder to prosecute family members who abuse other family members. That's what she's saying perfect example to. But instead, the Whitmer campaign has turned it into what you've just heard. And this ad has been running for months. And that's not her position on it. Her position, she's pro-life, obviously, because she's conservative, but she's also... Has this
gone out over the air?
Oh, yeah.
Broadcast?
Oh, yeah.
Can we contact... Is there any prominent right-wing lawyer who would take a lawsuit? Because isn't that defamation of character? Can't we sue on... Or somebody sue on her behalf if that's a claim she made and it went over and it's a false claim? It's slanderous and it's liable, isn't it?
Oh, if it's taken out of... I'm not a lawyer, but I think it's because since it was broadcast... But since it was taken out of context from like something that's available to the public, you know what I'm saying?
Well, I'm wondering if they're doing the... there's so much blame to go around that nobody's really to blame because everybody's to blame. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like... You get what I'm saying? Like, well, it wasn't the Whitmer campaign per se who financed and okayed this ad.
Oh, it's because it isn't, because you know, it isn't. That is not, that's from a PAC.
Yes. That's what, that gives them the fucking, the facade that works, sadly, that gives them protection. They go, well, this isn't, there's no individual to go after. It's a political
but
action.
But I've been letting that, like, shape my view that I'm fucking vote for this bitch now. Like,
this is why I'm like, I don't even know if people, we got Prop 3, which is basically what is going to be, seems like the wedge issue that's going to make people be this, that and the economy are going to be the single issues people are going to vote for if they're going to be single issues voter in the gubernatorial, right? Gubernatorial, you know the word I'm trying to say, race up here. But I have, but, and people talk about Prop 3 and they're like, well, it's confusing and this and this and this. And surprisingly, because remember when we were growing up and we were younger, it was the Democrats who wanted to explain things and simplify things and make you so you could understand it. And we want to make motor voter, remember mm-hmm. that? Register to vote immediately yeah. when you get your license. You don't even have to ask and all this shit. Now it's the opposite of, well, you can't understand how a legal bill is written. It's too hard for you to understand. It's too complicated. You're confused. You're too stupid to vote. And I'm like, wow, that sounds awful fucking 80s Republican to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and these people are saying, I mean, it's the same shit, man. It's the same nonsense.
When we were young, the party of the elites was a Republican and the party of the people was the Democrats. And they have fucking switched.
Which makes me, sorry for our discussion for another day, but just put it in your pipe and fucking dwell on this, dear listeners. And thank you for listening. Did they really switch or... did they just do, you know, move some scenery on stage and get us to think that they're now in a new location? I'm just throwing right. that out there.
Fair.
So,
just, you know, highlighting different parts of the parties.
No, you're absolutely, no. How they present themselves, yes, we are going through the biggest switch as far as the parties and their fucking, basically, their public perception of the party since the Southern Strategy. After the Civil Rights Act of 64, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. Where the U.S. lost a lot of Democrats that are what they call blue dog Democrats.
Yeah.
So.
All right. So, all right. Sniffing 3 hours. Haven't done this for a while. so, if you made it to the end, thanks for listening, and find us on social media at Gen Exhausted Pod on both Twitter and Facebook. Remember, Facebook, you can like us and share us, and you can retweet us and all that crap on Twitter. And yeah, hopefully Elon helps us out with the algorithm on Twitter there. Go to ChristopherMedia.net, hit the PayPal banner and the Amazon button if you'd like to help us out with a little bit of commerce. And wherever you listen to the show, rate it, review it. Help other people find it, because that's how you do things in 2022. We thank you guys for listening, and we'll catch you next week.
All right, later, guys.
See ya.
Thank you for visiting ChristopherMedia.net.